At Gaia Herbs, we work ridiculously hard, so our herbs work ridiculously hard for you. That's why, instead of making gummies with refined sugar, we developed our own organic fruit-based formula. And why we handpick our leaves off our ginkgo trees to avoid whatever's on the ground. And why we test and retest everything in the lab for maximum potency. Because the harder we work, the harder our herbs work for you. Explore our herbs at GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. That's GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. Gaia Herbs, the hardest working herbs on earth.
Hey, this is BJ. Thanks for listening to our show's podcast. If you're a fan of all things geeky, you should check out my other podcast, BJ Shea's Geek Nation. We have new episodes every day, and you can check it out at bjgeeknation.com.
Your home is going into foreclosure and you feel like a financial wreck. You don't know where to turn for accurate information. I'm bankruptcy attorney Travis Gagne. Let's talk about some legal options. If we work quickly, we can propose a plan to save your home, modify the loan, or in many cases, even eliminate your second mortgage. The consultation is free. I've helped hundreds of people just like you make informed decisions about whether to save their home or exit it on a reasonable, organized timeline. The chapter you choose sets the tone for the next chapter of your life. Please contact me today at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com.
99.9 KISW, the Rock of Seattle. So there's another video of a song going viral, which you can catch on the BJ and Migs page of KISW.com.
Uh-oh.
You want to see this video. It was originally posted a few years ago, but for some reason, people are digging it again. And it's Even Flow, the classic Pearl Jam song.
Oh, I bet why is about 4 or 5 days ago was the anniversary of Pearl Jam's 10. So I wonder if that renewed some interest.
Oh, wow.
Gonna make you feel old. I know, BJ.
I would have listened if I'd have known it was the anniversary. I would have listened to the album.
You can still listen to it, you Nimrod.
Oh, no, man. It's the anniversary's passed. Now I gotta wait till next year, until the next anniversary.
It's been 31 years. Yeah. Since this album came out. You've had 31 years to listen to this damn record, BJ.
I did, didn't I?
Yes, and you still
well, you
have
know
this.
What? There's still time. You know what I mean? There really is still time.
It's also the 26th anniversary. Same day they released No Code, which was one of their other records as well. So it's kind of funny. On the same day they celebrated the 31st anniversary of 10 and the 26th anniversary of No Code, which doesn't make me feel old at all.
No, not at all.
I feel super young.
Yeah, look at you. You know what? You're a spring chicken.
Yes.
And,
it's sad when you can remember exactly when you heard both of those records, and it was 31 and 26 years, respectively.
Yeah, I really don't remember because I didn't listen to the full record. I mean, I've heard some of the songs. Yeah.
It still infuriates me.
I know. I think a lot
of other rockaholics.
There's not much that gets you pissed, so really, I have to hold on to this.
I know.
I really do. You get bothered by nothing, and then I laugh because I'm like, of all the things he gets bothered by, this is it. This is great. I found the button to push.
I know. I need to start meditating and not let it bother me, and then maybe you'll listen.
I know, but it won't happen.
Yeah.
Because you know, I know. But here's the thing. I will listen to this. It's Even Flow turned into a smooth jazz song, which, you know, I mean, hey, listen, who's not into the smooth jazz, little cup of coffee, you know, wake up on the, you know, jazzy side. Now Eddie's still there. They kept his track, but they did change the music for this. And again, you can catch the video on the BJ and Migs page of KISW.com.
I might get my dad into Pearl Jam.
Yeah. How crazy would it be if he listened to 10 before I did?
Oh, dude. Oh, stop.
Yes.
This is the problem with these damn vocal-only videos out there, like where they isolate just the vocals and they're out there for people to do these mashups.
Yeah.
That was actually pretty fun.
It was fun. I feel like Eddie's just a little too, just a little too edgy for that smooth jazz version. You need a smoother pipes, I think, for that one.
It's the young, angry Eddie, of course.
Yeah, yeah.
Dude, exactly. It's nuts when you listen. I love sometimes listening to those vocal only posts that someone gets their hands on the vocals of, and they isolate it and they put it up on YouTube, and it's like you really appreciate just how cool of a voice Eddie has.
Yeah.
At least me personally. I know some people, like, they're not as much of a fan. I mean, thankfully a lot of people are, but I always love hearing those things.
Yeah, he's got a great unique voice. You know, I mean, you've got people that would be considered really like your typical great singer. Oh my God, that's a great voice. But you know, there are people like Eddie that you know it's different, but it's good.
He inspired hundreds of people to try and sound like him.
Yeah,
which is funny because a lot of people thought that he was trying to sound like Jim Morrison back in those days.
Well, yeah, and I'm a much bigger Pearl Jam fan than I am a Doors fan, but I can understand why they say that, and I still like Eddie better.
Oh, same.
And I like Eddie better. Hey, because he's better.
There so we said go. That sounded like an old porno music. I thought the pizza guy was going to show up and lay on the doorbell anytime.
Jazz does. Maybe that's why I like smooth jazz, because it's relaxing, but it's also arousing.
Oh, did not need to hear that this early in the morning.
It's a relaxing. I'm not sure how to, you know, but I see what he says. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to put that in your head.
Yeah, good morning, BJ.
Good morning, everybody. Put that visual out there for you as you're having your breakfast. Well, over the weekend, this big stuff, Ichiro was inducted into the Mariners Hall of Fame. And Steve is convinced that something happened during the ceremony that will surely piss me off. Steve will tell you all about it. He's got the mix report for you. He'll do that at 6:17 on The Rock.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW.
At Gaia Herbs, we work ridiculously hard, so our herbs work ridiculously hard for you. That's why, instead of making gummies with refined sugar, we developed our own organic fruit-based formula. And why we handpick our leaves off our ginkgo trees to avoid whatever's on the ground. And why we test and retest everything in the lab for maximum potency. Because the harder we work, the harder our herbs work for you. Explore our herbs at GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. That's GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. Gaia Herbs, the hardest working herbs on earth.
99.9 KISW, the Rock of Seattle.
Well informed on the issues of the day? Not this guy. Live from the KISW News Center in downtown Seattle, this is the Migs Report.
Well, thanks, you guys. Thanks to Kia Puyol for giving us the Migs Report today. Enjoy some lemon juice. It's National Lemon Juice Day.
Oh, all right, then.
But more importantly, it's a happy belated birthday to Vicky B Day.
Aww.
Was it yesterday?
Thank you. Yes,
that's
yesterday.
Right. I lost track of the weekend. I know I texted you. I just don't remember if it was yesterday or the day before. It was just a whirlwind of a weekend, so I'm very happy for you.
I feel like we're still hungover from Chicago.
Dude, no kidding. Just when I think I'm starting to feel normal again, the weekend hits, and now I'm back to crap.
Well, I appreciate, though, the birthday wishes.
What'd you do over the weekend?
Hung out. We had a steak dinner at my parents'
Ooh.
House. It was all kinds of fancy. Little brother fell asleep on me, and I took a nap. It was a great time.
What a party.
Steak and naps? That sounds like a great party.
Yeah.
I had a great time yesterday.
I feel like, look, I mean, there were times where we did stuff that were different about 10 years ago. That's all I'm saying.
My friends that surprised me came over. We had some drinks at my house. All that fun stuff on Saturday.
Oh,
so I did get a surprise.
Okay. All right.
All right, let's talk a little bit about what happened over the weekend as well. I don't know if you were celebrating with Ichiro or watching any of the Mariners games, but what a weekend over at T-Mobile Park as everybody showed love and tribute to Ichiro Suzuki getting inducted into the Mariners Hall of Fame. Lots of stuff happened. I'll try and go through a couple of the things that I thought were pretty fun. One of the things that happened on Friday night, so Friday night they kicked off Ichiro weekend, and what did they do? They brought out somebody from his past. An odd thing from the past that I completely forgot about. Do you remember Ichiro Girl?
Vaguely.
Don't feel bad, dude. I actually had to do an internet search at first because, like, Ichiro Girl is throwing out the first pitch. I'm like, who? Did she write a song? I just forgot there was a moment during one of the games way back in the day, back in 2010. This girl by the name of Iris Skinner, she was out there in the outfield.
Oh, yeah.
Ichiro tried to catch a foul ball. He ended up landing on her and touching her. And then the camera stuck on her for a while because she was freaking the F out that Ichiro Suzuki just touched her. And it was pretty awesome. In fact, here's the old call from 2010 where the announcers and the commentators were just laughing about the fact that this girl was losing her mind.
Pop up into shallow right field and down the line, slicing over to foul territory. Ichiro gets over, reaches into the crowd, and he can't get to it down the line. Young fan down there, very excited. She almost came away with the baseball, and she's getting ready to get on her cell phone to tell everybody what just took place.
Ichiro.
coat, touched her with his glove, and she is freaking out. This is hysterical.
I love the laughing in the background. They're just losing their mind. She had to text her mom. So what do? They get a hold of this girl by the name of Iris. Again, what is this now? 12 years later.
Yeah.
And have her throw out the first pitch. And the best part is they once again surprised her with Ichiro. She had no idea when she went out there on the mound to throw out the first pitch, the ceremonial first pitch, that catching the pitch would be Ichiro in full Mariners garb. So she's just like, goes there on the mound. She's like, what the hell? Now there's Ichiro right there.
Wow, that is. I do remember that now. I remember that it was just so funny seeing her freak out so much in right field when basically he touched her with his glove.
Well, Iris seems like an awesome person because again, she did not freak out as much this time around, but she was definitely losing it because she got to get a picture with him, talk to him, and here's that moment when she got to throw out the first pitch, being surprised by Ichiro.
Now, please welcome Ichiro girl, Iris Skinner, and to Iris's surprise. Here comes Ichiro himself, the catch that pitch.
She's still Ichiro, girl.
Thank you so much. Hi, can you sign me?
You didn't know at all?
No one told me. This is so awesome. Oh, my God.
She's just bouncing, losing her mind. Ichiro, not only wearing the jersey and the hat, but the pants and the socks, too. Like, he's ready to play a game.
Dude, he looks good.
I love him.
Boy, he looks fantastic. He does look like he could play again in any moment.
And then Saturday, it was the big day where like the full induction was happening. They brought out all the former teammates. They had all these great video presentations before the game. It was a pretty awesome spectacle. And Ichiro went up there and gave a great speech. Started up by just yelling, "What's up, Seattle?" Sold out T-Mobile Park, just losing their minds. And then he shared throughout the little like video packages there, had some fun clips of like Ken Griffey Jr. used to prank him, so he mentioned that as well. But he did show a lot of love for Jr., and this was a pretty cool moment where he talked about how Ken Griffey Jr. was just like one of his idols, and he was so excited to play for the Mariners because that was Jr.'s team.
He was my idol even before I came to America. In 2009, he returned to Seattle, and I finally got to be his teammate. He's a jokester, but for me, he's also a true professional. He helped me in more ways than I can express. Being his teammate is truly one of my career highlights.
Pretty cool stuff right there from Ichiro talking about Ken Griffey Jr., who was, you know, wiping away some tears while all that was going on. But there was a moment during the induction ceremony that I'm pretty sure is going to make you very upset, BJ.
Okay, because I didn't see the full ceremony. I saw the highlights, so I'm let's see what happened.
Oddly enough, I have to catch most of it because I was at a wedding, but it was close enough to our house. No, that's not as bad as you think. I had to go back home and let Lulu out and spend a little time with Lulu because it was a long day because, you know, Tatum was a ring girl or flower girl. And so we were there early and all this. So I was like, okay, let me go run home in between the ceremony and the reception and hang out with Lulu for a little bit, let her out. And it was right during the induction thing. So I was like, this is awesome. I'm catching this great moment. Then I had to get back in my car and I listened to it on the radio when this moment happened, which is funny because I didn't get to see the subtitles. So I was very confused what was going on. And the whole time, like, oh boy, if BJ saw this, I'm sure he was throwing his hands in the air. So all these great people are talking about Ichiro. And then they decide to have a video message from Ichiro's dogs.
Oh, boy.
And here's how that went.
Now, we all know Ichiro and Yumiko have always loved dogs. Ichiro, we have a very special congratulations video from Kikyu and Tenro. I'm not kidding. These are two amazing dogs. Please direct your attention to Mariners Vision for one of the greatest congratulatory videos of all time.
Without the subtitles?
Yes.
And they didn't explain what they
said. I don't know about you, but I understood every word they barked.
Well, what they said, because, the whole time, like, this is going, and I edited it down. This is going on for a really long time where they just had these dogs howling. What the hell is happening?
Okay.
I watched the video back later on in the night, and then apparently the dogs, I don't know if you wanted to know what they said
to
Ichiro.
What did the dogs say to Ichiro?
You always say good boy, good girl to us. Now we want to shout to the world, good boy to you. You are an M's Hall of Famer. Good boy. Good boy. Good boy. We are so proud of you. Can we have extra treats tonight?
Yeah.
From Ichiro's dogs.
You know, there you go.
See, I found great humor in this because I knew this was going to make you very upset.
Of course, it irritates me more that Vicky likes this. So, because there's so many Vickys out there. I'm just like, oh, God help us.
Fantastic.
Yeah, I would. You're absolutely right. I am so happy that I was. If I was at the park and saw that, I probably just would have said, I'm going to go get many beers. That's the dumbest thing ever. It is so dumb. It is so, and it really just to me ruined everything. And now I feel like his Hall of Fame thing is tainted.
You're wrong. The thing that ruined everything is the fact that we could have swept the Guardians, but because of a crappy eighth inning on Saturday, when all the great festivities are happening, Mariners are up 3-1. Andrés Muñoz comes in. He's been playing pretty well, so you can't give him, you can't crap all over the dude, but gives up 3 in the eighth, and they end up losing that game. But they won all the other games. They won yesterday. They shut him out 4-0. They won on Friday. They won on Thursday.
Yeah, the Guardians are a good team.
Yes.
So, I mean, you know, every once in a while, a good team is going to mount a comeback and get your guy sometimes.
And if you said, hey, Mariners, if they could get 3 out of 4 against the Guardians, I'd be like, damn straight. That sounds awesome. But when they lose the one where they should have won, you're like, they could have got the sweep.
Yeah, you kind of go, boy, I hope this doesn't, man, I hope it's not a big one.
So, anyways, of course, they're off today. They play again. They're off to Detroit. So we'll see how things go. Detroit's not a very good team, but they've been playing decently recently.
Yeah, I know. And look, I don't know the rules, but when September happens and they bring the call-ups, it gets a little tough because you don't know a lot of the pitchers. And, yeah, so we got to win these games is all I'm saying.
Oh, man, I think this might be the story of the year. And this is the headline.
All right.
A man was arrested after trying to call a prostitute while on his honeymoon.
Okay, yeah, you know what? The man deserves an award.
His name is Paul. He's 34 years old, and he was arrested because he entered an ad for a prostitute.
Wow.
Apparently, his now bride sleeping in the hotel room. So what does he do? Tries to meet up with a hooker while she's asleep.
I want to know the backstory of this because how do you still have the energy on your wedding night to like really decide you want to go do this unless...
It was his honeymoon, BJ.
His honeymoon. Ooh, boy. On his honeymoon. Jeez.
Well, I mean, he was just too tired to give him some love and he's like, you know what? I gotta put my foot down early in this marriage.
Yeah.
If you go to sleep on me, I'm having sex with hookers. Only problem is that he called a hooker that was not a hooker. It was part of a sting operation by local police. So he was arrested, and the sheriff joked the only question here was, as a wedding guest, was it too late to get the gifts that they gave returned back to them?
Yeah.
Because I can't imagine that marriage is going to last very long.
That's a big question. That is a very big question. Like, how long does the marriage have to last before, you don't get to ask for that gift back?
Yeah, I mean, if you spend some good money on, like, a nice, like, you know, like pots and pans or something.
A Vitamix?
A Vitamix? That was the first thing I thought, too.
Yeah, those are not cheap, Steve.
I was like, I ain't buying anyone a Vitamix.
Yeah, well, I mean, if you thought, hey, I really want the couple to have good fruit juices in their lives, you know, you want to get it done.
So we talk about the greatness and the excitement of the Mariners. Let's talk about the not-so-greatness and not-so-excitement about the Seattle Seahawks as they end up losing 27-26 to Dallas Cowboys, whatever.
Hey, but hey, we have a starter.
We do. In fact, here's Pete Carroll telling us.
And Gino's going to start. You know, he's going to start the opener, and he's earned it. He's won the job with the time and the time frames that got messed up for us for Drew. Drew just ran out of time in making his bid for it, and so I mean I'm clear about that. So I just want to let you know so everybody knows, so you don't have to ask about it anymore.
Yeah, I guess getting COVID right before you're about to have a start, and then having some tough effects from the COVID did not look very good for him when he got to play against the Cowboys over the week. I mean, he threw at first it was like, oh, look at Drew, he's throwing dimes, and then all of a sudden, look at Drew, he's throwing interceptions. And of course, that's something that Pete Carroll's not a fan of. Whereas Geno Smith did not throw many interceptions. I don't think he threw any. I don't think he had any turnovers in the 4 games, including that mock game that they did over at Lumen Field. Whereas Drew Lock had 3 interceptions during all
so
that.
That's
time.
It. So, I mean, the next time we see these guys on the field, it's for reals.
Yeah, with Geno Smith as the leader of your Seattle Seahawks.
You know what? He deserves a shot. I don't have a problem with this. And who knows, man? How cool would it be if the student becomes the master?
Yeah, do you really consider him the student?
Well, I mean, he's kind of Russell's student.
The backup becomes the starter.
Exactly. You know, I'm trying to pull a little sort of Star Wars relay. I mean, you're right. It's a stretch. It's a very large stretch.
That's a stretch. Yeah. Anyway, congratulations to Hawaii. They won the 2022 Little League World Series. They were just like, I mean, unstoppable. They won the game because of a mercy rule because they had 10 runs.
Wow.
And they did that. I guess they had a 10-run mercy rule throughout the entire Little League World Series, throughout all the games. They did that four times in the six games of the series.
Hawaii did?
Yes.
Wow. And how about they did it in the championship?
They scored 60 runs during the Little League World Series total in all their games and only allowed 5.
What is going on in Hawaii? I mean, I know it's good weather, so it's because they get to play baseball all the time.
They also have 20-year-olds playing it, I think.
Oh, the 20-year-olds, yeah. I thought that was just other countries that wouldn't be piping the 20-year-olds in, but now Hawaii has decided, like, hey, let's, if you can't beat them, join them with the 20-year-olds.
It's got to be like Hawaii here in the Pacific Northwest, boys. As it's 81 degrees will be our high.
Oh, I see what you did there.
Hey, thanks to WWE SmackDown at the Climate Pledge Arena coming on September 9th. That's very soon, just a few weeks away for the Mix Report, and that's what's up.
On Friday, Steve did get this one wrong.
Dump, floater, and wipe are all terms used in which team sport?
Soccer.
No.
Floater. Basketball.
No.
Football.
No.
I don't know.
In the
baseball?
No.
Yeah,
I ran out of sports, Vicky.
I know.
Yeah, dump, floater. I mean, that's a great question. Because all I'm thinking of is the toilet bowl. That's the special game you play, you know. No, we were looking for volleyball, actually. That was the answer. You want a shot at beating Steve? All right, you got it. 206-421-ROCK. We'll play Beat Migs at 647.
Today's podcast is brought to you by bankruptcy attorney Travis Gagne, who's ready to answer your questions about bankruptcy. Travis, is it true that if you filed for bankruptcy once, you can't file again?
Even if you filed bankruptcy before, you can almost certainly file bankruptcy again. Different types of bankruptcies have different time limits between filings. In Chapter 7, full bankruptcy, you can only file Chapter 7 once every 8 years. However, you can always, almost always file a Chapter 13 case. Chapter 13 cases can be filed immediately following a Chapter 7. They can be filed immediately following a prior Chapter 13 case. Chapter 13 is a reorganization plan, so there will be some type of monthly payment, but it's based on your budget and your ability to afford that payment. So Chapter 13 is an option in almost all cases, even with a prior bankruptcy filing.
Thanks, Travis. If you have more questions about bankruptcy, you can reach out to Travis anytime at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com. Thanks for listening.
At Gaia Herbs, we work ridiculously hard, so our herbs work ridiculously hard for you. That's why, instead of making gummies with refined sugar, we developed our own organic fruit-based formula. And why we handpick our leaves off our ginkgo trees to avoid whatever's on the ground. And why we test and retest everything in the lab for maximum potency. Because the harder we work, the harder our herbs work for you. Explore our herbs at GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. That's GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. Gaia Herbs, the hardest working herbs on earth. At Gaia Herbs, we work ridiculously hard, so our herbs work ridiculously hard for you. That's why, instead of making gummies with refined sugar, we developed our own organic fruit-based formula. And why we handpick our leaves off our ginkgo trees to avoid whatever's on the ground. And why we test and retest everything in the lab for maximum potency. Because the harder we work, the harder our herbs work for you. Explore our herbs at GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. That's GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. Gaia Herbs, the hardest working herbs on earth.
Hey, this is BJ. Thanks for listening to our show's podcast. If you're a fan of all things geeky, you should check out my other podcast, BJ Shea's Geek Nation. We have new episodes every day, and you can check it out at BJGeekNation.com.
Your wages are being garnished. We can stop that now. It's hard enough to pay your bills when things are good, let alone when a big chunk of your take-home pay is gone before you even get your check. I'm bankruptcy attorney Travis Gagne, and I can stop the garnishment and get the creditors off your back immediately, often the same day as our consultation. Both Chapter 7 and 13 provide bankruptcy relief, but choosing the right chapter is crucial. In a free consultation, we can create a plan to get your finances back under your control. The chapter you choose sets the tone for the next chapter of your life. Please contact me today at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com.
99.9 KISW, the Rock of Seattle. And yeah, pain in the grass, it is back.
Oh, we got a while until we can get to pain in the grass, though, right?
Oh, yeah, we only just have till this weekend.
Nice.
I think it's finally here. This is the weekend.
Let's go.
Woo!
Very exciting.
Days, Labor Day weekend. We have a holiday weekend, too, coming up.
Yes, sir.
Oh, yeah, so good. I mean, you got three big days of great music. We've been talking about it. This is the summer event of the Pacific Northwest. Steve, I know you're looking forward to some of these bands, if not all of these bands.
Pretty much all of them. I mean, every band I'm going to be able to check out, I'm excited to see. Of course, Incubus on Friday night. Then you got Alice in Chains, Bush, Breaking Bad, some great local bands. A'Ron Jones going to be there. Just dropped a brand new song that's phenomenal, BJ. So I'm excited to see that live. Thunder P, it's another great band.
I can't
get the full name, but we do love. I'm very excited to see them live as well. And then on Sunday, you got Queensryche. That's going to be awesome. Of course, Sammy Hagar and the Glorious Sons. It's going to be a blast, BJ.
Yeah, and also there is a kickoff party happening Wednesday. This just a couple days if you want to head out to the Moore Theater to see the Pretty Reckless and A'Ron Jones. And also we got tickets, a limited number of tickets for the BJ and Migs party. Get to see the BJ and Migs first annual weenie toss. First ever. I don't know if it's going to be the annual, but it's the first ever.
Well, I guess we're going to judge it by how it goes this weekend.
Yeah. So if you want more info, you want tickets, you know where to go for Pain in the Grass. KISW.com.
Let's play B. Migs.
It's time to play the game. Woo! So everybody scream his name. B. Migs. Don't be a loser. Whoa! B. Migs. You're a loser.
Happy Monday, everyone, and happy Pain in the Grass week.
Woo!
So get all awake, because I don't think we are.
Get all awake.
Get all awake. I don't know if it's a...
I don't know. I was digging it, though.
Really bad hip-hop song. But
yeah, but it done really well.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, like I said, happy Monday. Today we have Millie from Kirkland. Millie, are you there?
I'm here. Good morning, BJ.
Good morning, Millie.
Now, see,
you know what? The rest of you forget about it. Don't have a good morning. No. Just me. You know,
I'm just going to have a morning.
Good morning, BJ.
Good morning, Bob.
All right, Steve, get out of here.
Goodbye. Yeah.
For those playing at home, Millie has 60 seconds to answer 10 questions, and you can pass all you want, but you do only get 3 guesses per question. Are you ready?
I am ready.
Who is the main antagonist in the 101 Dalmatians?
Cruella de Vil.
Correct. What letter is used most in the English language?
E.
Yes. An affogato is a gelato topped with what?
Say again.
An affogato is a gelato topped with what?
Cass.
Typically, how many wheels does a pair of roller skates have?
6.
Nope.
4.
Nope.
8.
Yes. The Girl Scouts of America was formed in what decade?
50s.
Nope.
60s, 70s.
Nope. How many ounces are in a gallon?
16.
Nope.
64.
Nope.
62?
No. Gaston is 8. The main villain from what Disney film?
The Beast.
Oh, you better get your pass.
Come on. Pass.
In the United Kingdom, Charlie is slang for what drug?
Crystal meth?
No. You got 3 correct.
Wow. You know what, Millie? I thought Millie was going to be the one.
You started off a little strong, but like I said, it's Monday.
Yeah, I thought it was going to be the great hope, but he was not.
So depressing, BJ.
I know.
Apologies, BJ.
I know. I love
walking in on someone apologizing to BJ.
There's still a chance, though.
All right,
Millie. We'll see if Steve can let us down.
All right, Steve.
If he's got that pre-holiday pain in the grass.
Oh, it's a busy weekend. Yeah, a rehearsal dinner, a wedding. And then I wrestled yesterday outside in the sun.
Oh, wow.
Over at the White Center block party at the Lariat Bar, which is awesome. Shout out to the Lariat Bar real quick. That place rules. If you're a wrestling fan, it's got all this crazy wrestling memorabilia in there. It's in White Center, which is pretty awesome. I ran to our old bud Ben the Psycho Muppet was there.
Aww. Oh, cool.
So that was cool to catch up with him. He was just randomly at the block party, and he saw I was wrestling in a ring outside. He's like, I should watch this.
Of course you should. Yeah, I would.
It was awesome. It was good to see him again.
Aww.
Yes.
All right. Well, with all that, Steve, are you ready?
I don't know.
Okay, we
shall
see.
Might not be.
Who is the main antagonist in 101 Dalmatians?
Oh, Cruella de Vil.
Correct. Nice. What letter is most used in the English language?
A.
No.
E.
Yes. An affogato is a gelato topped with what?
Avocado.
No.
What was the question?
Affogato is a gelato topped with what?
Affa.
Affa? No.
Yeah. Apple.
No.
Pass.
Well, you already said three.
Okay, fine.
Typically, how many wheels does a pair of roller skates have?
Four.
No.
Oh, eight.
Yes. The Girl Scouts of America was formed in what decade?
The 50s.
No.
60s.
No.
30s.
No. Oh. How many ounces are in a gallon?
Is it the 40s?
No.
Okay, good. 16.
No.
64.
No.
48.
No.
72.
No. Right. Gaston is the main villain from what Disney film?
Gaston. Lion King.
No.
Cinderella.
No.
Sleeping Beauty.
No. Oh. In the United Kingdom, Charlie is slang for what drug?
Heroin.
No.
Cocaine.
Yes. What chess piece makes an L-shaped move?
Ooh, I'm going to go with the bishop.
No.
The rook?
No.
No.
Two, three, four. Barely squeaked by. 4-3.
Big win.
Millie
Big win.
Got Beauty and the Beast, Millie. Oh, you were so close.
Yeah, he only said the Beast, the movie. Yep. Alrighty.
That's not my problem.
Well, you can tell everybody.
Mm-hmm. Beast, you figure like, well, I mean, doesn't that go in your head, Beauty and the Beast? No.
Well, all I know is that Sarah continues to be the heater.
Yeah, I got to get Joey back in that room.
Aww.
Since Sarah's been in the other room. Oh, man, I don't think Danny should come back.
Yeah.
This has been good.
Joey, go in that room, cool it down. Your father needs to play some victory songs over Steve.
I don't know, man. I guess I really am the bad luck charm.
Yeah, you are.
I don't know how this happened, and Steve and I shared in going to a wedding this weekend. Different wedding, of course, but...
Oh, you were the flower girl at a wedding?
I was,
just like Lil Tatum. Nice.
It was beautiful. He got a little rambunctious, though.
At least they gave him a nap and a bottle. He was fine. Does anybody know what affogato is? Gelato topped with what?
I'm going to guess whipped cream.
Mm-mm.
Ah, dang it.
Joe?
Strawberries.
I have no idea.
Espresso.
Espresso.
It's espresso on gelato.
Oh. You act like you knew. Did you always know this?
Yeah, like affogato means basically some kind of coffee or espresso on something.
Oh, all right. Well, I'm not going to, you know, then I'm going to say okay, because you are the, you know, I have never heard of that even.
So the affogato part isn't like a playoff of gelato?
That I don't know.
Oh, I didn't know that. I thought it was like two words combined, like a coffee gelato. So that's the affogato. So, you know what I mean?
Because I thought espresso was Italian.
I thought this word was Italian.
I
assume this word was Italian.
I don't know.
That's what I'm saying. So, like, if gelato's Italian and espresso's Italian, they made up a new word to make calling it affogato. All right.
Yeah, I guess.
I like to forget about it is what I'd like to do.
All right. Does anybody know the decade in which the Girl Scouts of America was formed?
I thought it was the 20s.
A little earlier.
Is it the 10s?
Mm-hmm. 1912.
All right.
It's very, very old.
Yeah, it really is.
Ounces in a gallon, anyone? No, no, yes, no.
32?
No, it's a lot of them.
Oh, 128.
Yep, there you go.
Yeah, that's right. Dang it. 64. 64 is a half gallon, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, I went the wrong direction. I went 32, and I thought, I feel like that's a quart now.
All right, does anybody know the chess piece that makes the L-shaped move?
Everybody but Steve.
Okay, Joe, what is it?
The knight.
Correct.
Damn it, it did not work out how I hoped.
I raised a geek. Come on, the kid knows he knows a little bit about chess.
Well, I can't ask Vicky because she knows the answer.
Yep. Exactly. Sarah, did you know? Yes or no?
Well, no, I didn't know.
No.
Oh, all right. Well,
I was trying to give you a little more credit.
Well, you know what? I didn't want to make Sarah look bad because she's my heater.
Yeah.
But congratulations. You did squeak by 4-3.
Yeah, good luck to you. I mean, you know what? You got to win those one-run games once in a while, so whatever.
I didn't blow it in the eighth, I tell you that.
That's all right. It's all right. It's one game. We still won 3 out of 4, buddy.
That's right.
All right. Well, you know, congratulations to you and everybody that knows you. A woman, she knows she broke into tears, and it's because her dad accomplished something completely ridiculous, and you're going to hear what happened at 717 on The Rock.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW,
The Rock of Seattle. There's a Nebraska man by the name of Dwayne, and, he broke a world record by paddling 38 miles down a river in a carved-out giant pumpkin.
Okay, that's a phenomenal feat.
Yeah, I it's amazing when some people go, you know what, I wonder if there's a record for this. And the video is just
why is there a record for this?
Yeah, I don't know.
It's kind of funny because it looks like a a melted kayak. Like, it almost feels like, you know, because it's like it's giant legit pumpkin and it's all kind of like shriveled in a little bit. So it looks like he's just dealing with a real poor man's kayak.
I mean, it makes me wonder if, in fact, this is what the old school folks used to do. You know, maybe this is what, like, you know, the old folks that lived in this country all those years ago, man, that's what they used to carve out pumpkins and go floating around.
Pretty impressive if that's the case. And why haven't we heard of it until now?
I'm with you on that. But his daughter, Morgan, she told him how proud she was, emotional. Like, I mean, this brought her to tears as she told him how proud she was of him.
He always has said that you can do anything that you want.
Thank you. I hope my daughter grows up to be blindly proud of me of the ridiculous things that I do as well.
I mean, you know, I mean, in a way, I mean, look, she used that as a, like, wow, you told me I could do anything I want, and you prove you can do anything you want. I think it's the dumbest thing ever, and yet she might be able to use that to do whatever she wants in life. I mean, who knows what epiphanies, where they come from.
What was the inspirational moment that made you become the CEO of this, like, Fortune 500 company? Well, my dad, he floated in a giant pumpkin.
Let me tell you a story about a pumpkin.
Even dad was, like, kind of like, okay, you don't have to, like, cry.
Yeah, he's like, wow. You know, I mean, okay.
You think she was drinking? Because it looked like everyone was like drinking some wine over there.
Oh, that's very possible. Yeah, I could, because
I can, look, see Sarah doing that then.
Yeah.
Getting like emotional drunk over something ridiculous that you pulled off.
That has to explain it.
Right, Sarah?
Oh, yeah. For sure.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Sarah, you need to get emotional drunk over something that I do. Like, maybe I win a board game or something, and really tell me how inspiring it is for you.
If you give me some wine, it doesn't take much to make me cry.
Yeah.
Let's get real.
Well, I do love that this pumpkin is named the SS Bertha.
Oh, very cool.
Sorry, that is the greatest thing.
How long is he going to get to use this pumpkin? Like, one float and then done? I mean, like,
I mean, did he Simonize it? That's the thing. Did he, you know, is it like, is it just a pumpkin? He didn't do anything but carve it out, or did he protect it a little bit?
He sprayed the inside with that Flex Seal stuff that you see in those infomercials.
Yeah, maybe that's what it was. I kind of want to know more about this.
Yeah, I really want to know how much pumpkin seeds got out of that.
I was thinking that, too. Like, I bet he had some pretty big-ass pumpkin seeds to eat.
Well, that's his reward for, you know, floating all those miles down the river in a carved out pumpkin.
It's the lukewarm topic of the day.
Yeah, might be the dumbest thing you've ever heard of, and he set a record doing it.
Which means he beat somebody else's record.
Yes, so someone else is carving out pumpkins and going down the river.
I hope it's his neighbor, and this is just what the two of them do.
Oh, and it's going to be a battle. It's one.
Right. Damn it, Dwayne. I don't have enough time to haul out a pumpkin. I got to wait till next season.
My kid used to cry at me, and now you took that away from us because you beat mine. All right, so this daughter brought to tears when her dad broke a record for floating in a river in a giant carved out pumpkin. Based on this, we want to know, what ridiculous thing did you or someone you know accomplish? 206-421-ROCK, text us at 77999. All right, what ridiculous thing did you or someone you know accomplish? We got your calls. We got your texts after Nirvana on The Rock.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9
KISW, The Rock of Seattle. A daughter was brought to tears when her dad broke a record for floating in a river in a giant carved out pumpkin. We have the video, by the way, for you to see on the BJ and Migs page of KISW.com, so you can see this very teary-eyed moment.
Well, it's also worth a visit just to see the dad in the pumpkin, because the pumpkin I expected it to be bigger. I don't know why, because you hear a giant pumpkin, but it was big enough for him to sit in, but that's about it.
Yeah, it's...
It floats.
It floats, and it's big enough for him to sit in, so it's a...
And when I originally saw the story, I thought, oh, daughter must be like 12 or something. You know what I mean?
No.
It's a grown woman. I think a little wine drunk. I could be wrong, but she definitely felt the emotions. She was proud of her dad.
Right. I feel like she's a bit wine drunk. That's my thing. Because, again, the normal reaction is like, Dad, what are you doing? Why are you in a pumpkin?
I'm here because my dad wants to do this. And it's kind of silly, but I'm happy to see that he was able to make it happen.
Yeah, I mean, it looks like they had a good amount of people. They were all like, let's drink wine and see this idiot in a pumpkin. And it turns out he breaks a record. At least that's why I would have gone. That would have been my headline. Hey, guys, what are you doing this weekend? So we're wondering, man, based on this, what is what's that ridiculous thing that you know, did you or someone you know accomplish? 206-421-ROCK, text us at 77999.
The texts are flying in. Someone said, after an Army field exercise, I went to Red Lobster and I ate 23 plates of shrimp scampi. I respect that. Whoa.
23 plates?
Yes.
Whoa, that is an accomplishment.
In college, it was rare, but it was like fine dining when we had enough money to go to Red Lobster. Like, a few of us are like, dude, let's just do it. Screw it. Like, you know, I don't know how we're going to eat for the rest of the week, but let's go to Red Lobster. Especially if they did like one of their all-you-can-eat, like, they used to do all-you-can-eat shrimp, and then they had, I think they used to do all-you-can-eat crab, but that one didn't last very long. Because they're probably idiots like us that would just show up and spend hours just eating until we were sick. And it was the best times, though.
Oh, man. My accomplishment was eating a dozen donuts, which also got me very sick.
That's a lot, man. I don't think I've ever eaten a dozen. I think the most donuts I've ever had in one sitting, maybe three. Oh, Krispy Kreme, maybe four or five.
Three? Wow. Yeah. I was going to say, you're a lightweight.
Clearly.
Yeah, three is nothing.
We're talking Krispy Kreme donuts?
These were Dunkin' Donuts, actually.
So those are bigger.
They were bigger, yeah.
And girthier.
Oh, dude. I mean, granted, I mean, it took me a course of a few hours to get the whole box done, but I mean, it wasn't like I just sat down and went one after the other, but I killed the box over the course of a morning.
Was it a dare, or was it just because you were enjoying the donuts?
Yeah, I was enjoying the donuts.
Donuts are delicious. I'm not here to judge.
But the problem was, here's the problem. I would have to use the restroom. You'd think that would be an indicator. Okay, that's enough. You've had enough donuts because your body's like, dude, too many. But you know what? I'm like, all right, well, you know what? We just made room for more. Let's go.
It's a fair rationale behind why you would keep
shooting. I don't know why I was like 60 pounds overweight. I just cannot figure it out.
I don't know either. I'll let you know when I figure it out, too.
Yeah, I don't know what happened then. 206-421-ROCK, text us at 77999. What ridiculous thing did you or someone you know accomplish?
Someone just texted him saying, for 2 years running, I was the giant pickle-eating champ at our local street fair.
Oh.
So what does that involve?
That is ridiculous.
Eating it the fastest or eating the biggest pickle?
Yeah, that's a...
And is it a time thing?
And we don't know the gender of this person, but obviously, you know, you could be popular depending upon people if they like to watch you eat a pickle.
Well, I said eat it, not swallow it.
Well, part of eating it is swallowing it. I mean, you eat a banana, right? Okay. I mean,
that's a good point. No, you're right. I mean,
there you go.
Somebody said, I'm in the military. A friend of mine holds the company record for the most consecutive missed shots while trying to qualify with his weapon. He went 0 for 40 seven times. He claimed his glasses were dirty. Ha ha.
Oh, that guy's he's eligible to be a stormtrooper. Sign him up for the them right now. Good for him.
I was about to say, maybe you should be our cook.
Yeah. That's the guy I want. I want that guy. I want to run from that guy if he's a law enforcement and I decide I want to escape. I want that guy then to be the guy that chases me.
A texter said I ate 28 goldfish at a frat party, beating the record of six.
That's a lot more than you had to do, sir.
Yes.
I got slapped in the face.
By a goldfish?
Yeah, that goldfish was not happy with me. No, it was my wife, who I didn't realize that she was kind of on her way to being a vegetarian, and I was drunk, and that was everybody, that's what people used to do, swallow goldfish at parties. I don't know why that was a thing, but I'm like, sure, I was trashed. I'm like, I'll swallow a goldfish, and then next thing I know, she's just slapping me going, how dare you? And I'm like, what? Why? Everyone's doing it. Well, and, you know, she's like, no, you know, if you're being my boyfriend, you're not going to swallow goldfish. I've never seen, my wife usually
the sacrifices
chill.
You made to be with your wife.
I know, but I mean, it is funny to think, like, you know, what gets her goat. Like, she really doesn't get bothered by anything, but boy, she was pissed.
Has anyone else swallowed a goldfish?
No.
I did in college.
They used to do the thing. Yeah. Did you? Oh, you did too?
Yeah, it was back in the fraternity days, of course. It happened, and it was the weirdest feeling.
Oh, yeah.
Because I don't even like swallowing, like, aspirin or, like, Tylenol. Like, that gets me all, like, weird. And I'm like, okay, here we go. It's like, we got to do it.
Because it's alive? Because that's what would freak me out about it.
Yeah, that was why I had to be drunk.
Can you feel it wiggling in your stomach?
Oh, it's so long ago, I don't really remember, but I remember it was just, like, a sensation. I was like, never doing that again.
Yeah, it was weird going down. I didn't actually feel it in my stomach so much, Joe, but I did feel it going down, and it felt, now maybe I was making it up, but it felt like it was swimming down. It was weird, man.
And side note, if you guys think of trying this now, a lot of people have gotten arrested in the last 10 plus years. Yeah, animal cruelty.
What?
Yeah, there's a guy in 2014. Alive. Yeah, was fined $200 and banned from owning any pets ever. Because
okay,
he did
so, I'm hoping I'm grandfathered out of that clause.
Oh, yeah.
Can I just ask a question because I'm a douche? And no. How is having lobster not animal cruelty?
Because they kill it before you eat it.
No, they boil it alive. You can't kill it or release it.
Yeah, that's how you kill it. You boil it alive. But they still had to kill it before it went in your mouth.
It's a slow kill. It's the same thing as what we do to the goldfish. It's getting boiled alive in our stomach by our acid.
I mean, it's a matter of minutes. I agree with you. But like,
it's quicker for the goldfish to go, to be honest with you.
How hot is your mouth? I mean,
Oh, my mouth's very hot.
There is a way to humanely kill them. It's to do it literally with a chef's knife right before you put it in the water.
Are you sure?
That's the lobster or the goldfish?
Lobster.
Okay. Yep. I heard there was toxins, which is why they boil them. They got a way to do that now?
Yeah, if you kill it beforehand, I think you have like 10 minutes or something. I remember in my cooking class, the one class I didn't suck at.
Oh, wow. All right.
You do have a small window. So literally do it and then put it in the water.
So they don't boil them alive anymore. They do kill them beforehand.
Some people might.
Well, that's what, I mean,
my neighbor used to boil them in beer.
Ooh.
Well, boiling them is okay if they're not, but I mean, I remember I thought they were alive, and I thought, this is horrific. All right, so now you can't do the goldfish anymore. You get arrested, or you get fined. You get fined. They just want their money.
So, BJ, you're right. It is ridiculous.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm not arguing with that, but there is that, like, that teeny tiny step between the two where I guess that you're not taking a lobster, just shoving it in your mouth, and that's how it dies.
Yeah, plus, no one has a pet lobster. People have pet goldfish.
True.
So in that eye, it makes sense. What?
I had a pet lobster for a few hours until we ate it.
Oh, see?
They got shipped from Maine Lobsters back when I lived with a roommate. And before he got home, I let them free in the house. So
they were your pet at that point.
Home, there's like four lobsters just walking around.
Well, yeah.
I tied everything only like 10 minutes before, but.
Be free until we take your life.
He's like, what the hell is this? I'm like, dinner tonight. Yeah. He was like, awesome.
Did you race him?
No, it's just they're just walking around like these.
That would have been weird if I came home and I'm like, what are you? And this is our. Oh, okay.
Yeah. Stu is making a music video. He's going to do a little lobster dance.
Someone said live fish and live shrimp, live octopus. It's a delicacy in some Asian dishes.
Yeah. Oh, really? Oh, I didn't even know that. Well, see, that's different. In other countries, they don't arrest you for dumb things.
No.
Imagine
imagine
you show up to a pet store and they're like, sir, you're on our record. Like, yeah. Why? Well, we heard that you once swallowed a goldfish and now you're not allowed to have a pet.
Yeah. I don't know. You know, I know that hunters and everybody have a code. I mean, I watch the show Alone and they want to make sure that the animal doesn't suffer and they have to honor the animal when they kill it. And, you know, this one dude's on there going, we should really all hunt our own food. We shouldn't have to buy packaged food. We lost the connection between us and the... And I'm like, oh, will you shut up? You're eating meat. I'm eating meat. I mean, I don't... The connection. Here's my connection. I'm hungry. I'm eating something. That's my connection.
We honored the goldfish by chugging a beer after we did it.
Yes. I don't got to be honor whatever, please. I mean, right now, you know what? I think it would be nice if I could honor a human being. I'm going to start with humans first. Then I'll worry about honoring, my Big Mac, all right? I'll worry about that first. I would like to honor my Big Mac. Thank you for giving Mayor McCheese. Thank you, Mayor McCheese, for giving your life for me. Yeah, I just never understood that. All right, well,
So I said you boil crabs alive, too. That's true.
Well, is it the same thing, though? Like Vicky said, I wonder if crabs can actually be killed.
I was also doing some more research. You could kill the lobsters by putting them in the freezer for 30 minutes beforehand, then boiling them.
So they're still freezing to death.
I know.
These poor lobsters.
How
I do
is
not,
that better?
What a terrible adult in life.
I'm not saying it's better. I'm saying this is other techniques that you can do so you don't get sick. But there's some research saying that lobsters don't actually have like a nervous system where they feel pain. There's others that say they do. But there's a lot of studies that say they don't actually feel pain.
Really?
That's according to the studies.
How do we know the goldfish feels any pain?
Yeah, it's still gross. I think that should just be illegal because it's gross.
I'm not getting fined for being gross. Otherwise, I would really be like, have no money.
Every morning, I'd be paying something. Yeah,
believe me, it would be legitimate. By the way, really kind of hard. Officer, I'd like to argue that I'm not gross, but yeah, no, you know what? I got to pay the fine.
So I said, look up Leon the Lobster on YouTube. It's a guy bought a grocery store lobster and now made it a pet. There's six episodes of Leon the Lobster on
YouTube. Of course there are.
Yes.
If this guy has more views than I do, I'm quitting
YouTube. What do you, let's play guess how many views Leon the Lobster, one of the episodes, has.
Oh, he probably has more than me. I'm going to give him 20,000.
20,000 views on one of the videos. Okay, yeah. Joe, what do you think?
1 million.
1 million. Vicky,
wow,
you
lot.
Looked.
Yeah, I looked enough.
Don't guess. All right, Sarah.
100,000.
100,000. You are all so wrong. 20 really? Million.
No.
No. No. No.
Yes.
No, Leon the friggin' lobster guy.
And it's just Leon the Lobster hanging out in a fish tank for 15 minutes.
It's over. You know what? I think humanity's had its shot. It's time for some other, I don't know, let the octopi rule the world. Apparently they're really smart. You know, let the dolphins take over. Because if this is what we're doing.
Ooh, he's got
that's
his own,
the video. That's it. Just he's crawling around. How many million views?
20 million. Oh, they got merchandise.
I've seen this so many times, and why?
I know. Maybe you play it in the background, and you just have it in the background because you love lobsters. I don't know. Like a screensaver.
20 million views. That guy got paid for this. He probably got some nice cash.
Would you like an I Love Leon t-shirt?
I would not, but thank you, sir.
It's a very cool looking shirt. It's like the I Love New York, but it says I Love Leon.
Yeah, that's it's got the I Heart Leon. That's great. Yeah,
it says Survive and Thrive.
Yeah, that's no, thank you.
They got all types of shirts, coffee mugs, whatever you need.
Yeah. Whatever I need,
stickers, tote bags.
No, thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
No?
Yeah, that's quite all right. Hey, this is a legitimate question. Apparently we now have to ask for quite some time. Did Tommy Lee pull out his wiener during a Motley Crue concert this weekend? It's legitimate. I mean, you got to ask that question every once in a while. Like, wait, Tommy. Yeah, we have the audio. You're going to hear this at 7:47 on The Rock.
Today's podcast was brought to you by Travis Gagne, bankruptcy attorney. He's here right now and has agreed to answer more of your questions about bankruptcy. Travis, if you're upside down in your mortgage, should you continue to make the payment?
Continuing to pay your mortgage or not is a complex decision because you're going to have to pay to live somewhere. You're going to have a housing payment. So continuing to make your house payment really depends on several factors. One is whether or not you have a second mortgage. The second one is how affordable your ongoing monthly mortgage payment is. Another issue is whether your mortgage is adjustable and you're facing an increase in your mortgage payments later on when interest rates go up. If you do have a second mortgage in this economy with the housing prices being down, oftentimes we can take off or strip off that second mortgage in a Chapter 13 case so that you'd only have the first mortgage to continue to pay.
Thanks, Travis. If you have more questions about bankruptcy, you can reach out to Travis anytime at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com. And thanks for listening.
At Gaia Herbs, we work ridiculously hard, so our herbs work ridiculously hard for you. That's why, instead of making gummies with refined sugar, we developed our own organic fruit-based formula. And why we handpick our leaves off our ginkgo trees to avoid whatever's on the ground. And why we test and retest everything in the lab for maximum potency. Because the harder we work, the harder our herbs work for you. Explore our herbs at GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. That's GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. Gaia Herbs, the hardest working herbs on earth. At Gaia Herbs, we work ridiculously hard, so our herbs work ridiculously hard for you. That's why, instead of making gummies with refined sugar, we developed our own organic fruit-based formula. And why we handpick our leaves off our ginkgo trees to avoid whatever's on the ground. And why we test and retest everything in the lab for maximum potency. Because the harder we work, the harder our herbs work for you. Explore our herbs at GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. That's GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. Gaia Herbs, the hardest working herbs on earth.
Hey, this is BJ. Thanks for listening to our show's podcast. If you're a fan of all things geeky, you should check out my other podcast, BJ Shea's Geek Nation. We have new episodes every day, and you can check it out at BJGeekNation.com.
Your driver's license is important so you can get back and forth to work, get your kids to school, and back and forth to daycare. If your license has been suspended because you can't pay your tickets, you can't do any of those things. Let's talk about Chapter 13 bankruptcy. You may have heard that tickets cannot be discharged, but they can be dealt with in a Chapter 13 case. Why not come in for a free consultation? The chapter you choose will make all the difference to your getting back, legally, on the road. Let's design a plan to pay off your tickets and restore your license immediately. I'm attorney Travis Gagne. Please contact me today at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com.
99.9 KISW, the Rock of Seattle. All right, well, Tommy Lee.
Tommy Lee's on a great run right now. I'm sorry. I'm all in for the Tommy Lee train wreck.
So what happened is there was a Motley Crue concert on Saturday in L.A. And, you know, drummer extraordinaire Tommy Lee reminded the audience that he posted a full frontal nude photo on his socials earlier this month. He had to let everybody know that.
So you give The Rock a hard time, a tough time, because he's a humble bragger.
Yes.
But really, the ultimate humble bragger is Tommy Lee.
Yeah, I guess it's not so humble brag. Yeah, he's not very humble at all about his bragging. No,
it's a good point. Never mind.
He also likes to sometimes say he's victimized by, like, I can't believe everybody's always talking about my penis. It's like, you know, Nikki's like, dude, that's because you keep showing everybody your penis.
right. No one talks about anyone. No one talks about Vince Neil or Mick Mars or Nikki Sixx's penis.
I have no idea what they're toting.
No.
You know why? Because it's just never, they've never brought it up in conversation.
And I'm happy to say I don't ever want to talk about or think about what they're toting.
Exactly. I mean, didn't really want to know that much about Tommy Lee, but you know, hey, look, there was this video and also he was always running around showing people anyway. So he had to remind everybody, hey guys, I did it again. I posted a picture of my action for all to see. And so he's like, you know what I'm going to do right now? And he comes out on stage. He's like, I'm going to show you my wiener. That's what I'm going to do. You know, why should everybody else be lucky enough? So what does he do? He offers to show his wiener to the crowd and pulls a live wiener dog out of his pants. So you can see the video of this
poor dog
on the BJ and Migs page of KISW.com. You're right. We talked about earlier about how, you know, you don't want to torment goldfish and lobsters, and then he's got a wiener dog in his pants.
Well, so what if the dog was like, oh, it looks like a chew toy?
Oh, gosh.
I hadn't even thought about that.
That'd be hilarious.
Yeah, that would have been. So here's how that went.
Some of you might have heard this before. A couple weeks ago, as I got out drunk, took a bunch of pictures of my posted on Instagram. They took them down from Instagram. If you guys want to see my wiener,
there he goes. And he pulls the dog out. And ha-ha!
I'd be Tommy. The person looking all around, seeing who's screaming because they want to see Tommy Lee's wiener.
Like, yeah.
You see? So I'm just like, yeah! Wait a second. What am I cheering for?
Yeah.
Well, we hopefully can see that joke on Wednesday because Motley Crue's going to be here at T-Mobile Park.
Yeah, well, you know what? That's fine. Look at the dog. Dog is like, this is my life. This is my life.
It's a cute dog.
Yeah.
Motley Crue, Def Leppard, and Poison. And I think Joan Jett as well over at T-Mobile Park this Wednesday.
And if you're the rest of Motley Crue, are you just like, well...
Well, they probably need a break to suck on some oxygen or have a drink of water.
Yeah,
Tommy... Yeah, you know what? Either do a drum solo or do your stupid wiener joke, but give us a couple minutes.
Yeah. Is he back or is he still not able to play?
No, he's back. He's back and playing.
Oh, so that's good for the folks going to see the show. That's awesome.
Yeah, and even before that, like, he was doing a few songs and then they would hand it over to a different drummer, but from everything I've been reading, he's back in full force.
Yeah, his wiener looks good. I mean, I'll give him that.
Oh, that was what was injured. Yeah, it wasn't his ribs, it was his wiener.
Yeah. Hey, look, man, you know what? The guy's keeping him in the news. I got to give him credit. You know, as much as I want to, I'd like to get down on him. That was kind of a funny bit. I'd be like, all right, I'll give it to you, Tommy.
And it was kind of like, well, he posted that picture on Instagram, kind of a boneheaded move. I get it. But like then, you know, now he's having some fun with it.
Gosh,
maybe,
you know,
boneheaded is not the right term.
Yeah, no, you don't want to use that. You know, I'm a conspiracy theorist, man. I don't know if it was boneheaded. I don't know, or if it was accidental. I really don't.
Or do you think this is his bright idea for, like, dude, ticket sales haven't been the best, Tommy. What should we do? I got an idea.
Yeah.
I'll show Mike Johnson, and then all the ladies are going to show up to the show.
Yeah, I mean, you know, after that Pam and Tommy show, I mean, maybe he just see the TV show that came out. Maybe he just decided to, like, you know what, I'm back in the news. Like you said, maybe we need to boost ticket sales. I just, you know, man, I wouldn't put it past him to go, yeah, I was drunk, that's why I did it. Yeah. So we talk about the not-so-humble bragger, Tommy Lee. Then we talk about the humble bragger, The Rock. But we have to talk about the real hero here.
Wait, real quick, did you enjoy the picture I sent you guys over the weekend in the group chat of me hanging out with The Rock?
Yeah, that was great.
I found, we joked about it, like, the Rock needs a giant cardboard cutout of him holding Teremana tequila. Lo and behold, end up at the Lariat Bar in White Center. Awesome wrestling-themed bar. Makes sense that they would have this. But towards the back, I started walking to the bathroom, whatever, and I look over, and I'm like, son of a bitch, there is actually a cardboard cutout of the Rock holding the Teremana tequila. So I, of course, had to get a picture with it.
Oh, of course.
And sent it to the entire crew.
Well, yeah, I immediately deleted the entire thread.
I saw that.
Yeah, I was, you know, I was like, but you know what? Now you can say you're friends with him.
Oh, I already did. He called me brother.
Yeah,
he called me brother. He tweeted brother at me.
You got to take a picture next to his cardboard cutout. I mean, this is a true friendship at this point.
If he gets married again, I'm sure I'll be invited.
Yeah. Well, I got news for you. I just feel like, you know, there's a better man out there. And we've talked about this before. There's somebody like The Rock that lets you know every darn thing he's doing, even if it's slightly good. And then there's another guy that does a lot of good things. And we wouldn't hear about it if people didn't actively try to figure this out. And that, of course, is a man named Keanu Reeves, who...
I can't... Yeah, I'm not going to crap on Keanu's cool stuff, David, because he does a lot of cool stuff and genuinely does not seem to want any credit for it.
Yes. He is the real hero, and he's pulling a Tom Hanks. This is what I love. If Keanu starts pulling a Tom Hanks and just starts showing up everywhere like Waldo and everybody's weddings and all sorts of celebrations, because there was a couple, a British couple named James and Nikki. They got married over the weekend, and they were holding their reception, just, you know, coincidentally, at the hotel where Keanu Reeves was staying. And they didn't know that until James ran into Keanu at the bar. And he's like, oh, man. Right. Hey.
I love the fact that Keanu Reeves is just posted up at the bar.
How cool is that?
That's great.
Again, and, you know, by the way, he's at the bar. Nobody knows he's there because he's not humble bragging like, hey, having Teremana, you know, because, you know, if that was The Rock at that bar, he'd be going, having Teremana at this great bar over here in some place.
I would love it if he was having a glass of Teremana.
Yeah. Keanu's probably just having a glass. He probably has his own whatever, but he makes it for himself. I want to make that up. It's a nice rum that Keanu only makes for himself. Doesn't even try to sell it. He gives it away to people.
It's the John Wicked rum.
Yeah. So, I like this idea. So, the guy says, hey, there's Keanu post up at the bar. Hey, I'm getting married, Keanu. What do you say? You want to come to my wedding? And Keanu was, maybe.
I do love that. I wonder how many drinks that the husband had prior to going up to, because, I mean...
Yeah, I'd have to have a couple.
Right, at least a couple shots, and then build up the courage, and then be like, hey, Keanu Reeves, big fan, you're awesome. I respect what you do when people mess with your dog. Like, that's awesome, and I love you. What about tomorrow? You think about maybe swinging by my wedding? Like, that seems like a pretty ballsy. But the worst he's going to say is no, or just blow you off.
And how about this? I guess this reception, because, like, it was an hour later. So Keanu did show up. It says an hour later he did show, even though he was tired from a long flight. And the bride, Nikki, said, quote, he was kind enough to do some pictures and our wedding photographer was able to capture some, too. Then he took the time to speak to some of our guests and have more photos done, even though he was tired. Well, he does, you know, and he looks just like John Wick. I was going to say, I wonder how much like Keanu he looked at, but he looks just like,
Yeah, he looks like Keanu Reeves.
He looks like Jesus, really. I mean, he's got that whole, you know, he really does have that, like, you know what, you're going to turn my water into, you know, some fine, wow. And there he is hanging out.
Oh, best wedding ever. Although, I'll be honest, I think I'd rather The Rock at my wedding.
Okay, well, you know what, Keanu probably would show up at your wedding. I'm not sure The Rock would show up at your wedding.
The Rock would show up, and he would take pictures, and he would post them, and we'd all be doing shots of Teremana together. It'd be a great time.
That's the only way you could get him to your wedding, is the only alcohol that's served as Teremana, and he'd bring it.
Or be like, dude, is it your cheat meal today? Because we got the hookup on some good food.
Oh, is that? Oh, okay, that's how you're going
to. And you could sit with next to me and my wife at the main table. Wouldn't that be hilarious if there's my wife? You know how like they do at the weddings where it's like everyone's got their tables and then the husband, the groom, maybe the bridal parties as well. They're all sitting at that one table. And if we just kicked everyone else out of that table, it's just me, my wife, and The Rock. Oh,
you're going to let your wife stay there. For a minute there, I thought maybe she was going to get the boot, too.
No. She gets to sit there, too. But, I mean, the middle, of course.
Of course. Oh, I thought for sure you'd have him on the other end. You don't want to share him with your wife. Your wife's on you're in the middle, buddy.
You know, that's why I need you around sometimes. Yeah, sometimes you do have good ideas.
Because The Rock, what's The Rock going to do? He's going to spend time talking to your wife. You don't want that. You just want him all to yourself.
All right, who are you picking? You got one celebrity to come to your wedding. Who is it and why?
Oh, boy.
And it can't be William Shatner.
It can't be William. Meanwhile, everything's The Rock, but I can't have my Rock guy.
Yes.
All right. I got to. All right. Well, give me some time now. I need to think of somebody else.
Okay, Joe.
Oh, man, that's a tough decision.
I don't know. Do you go with Tom Brady? It seems like he's on a little bit of a rough streak right now. He's dealing with some S, as he said in a press conference.
That is tough.
I'm 45 and I'm dealing with some S. I'm like, ooh. Oh, yeah, tough life.
He missed some practices. He might be a little angry for a wedding right now.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
I wonder what this S is.
I know, but he said that in the press conference because people were grilling him. He's like, I'm dealing with some S. I'm 45 and I'm like, what? Like,
oh, so it's old. It might be old guy stuff.
Oh, maybe it's like he's having a hard time, like,
yeah,
going to the bathroom.
Oh, I was.
Jeez. Poor Tom. What did he ever do to you?
Nothing.
I don't know.
Well, actually, took a Super Bowl away from this.
Okay, that's what he did. That's what he did.
Yeah, I don't think I would have Tom. I think too many people would hate him. Like, I want people, like, you know, because if you were in Seattle, I don't think they want to take pictures with
them. That's a very good point. You got to pick somebody that's not.
I'll be honest. If Tom Brady's at a wedding that I'm at, I'd be stoked to meet Tom Brady.
Oh, dude.
Hell yeah.
It'd be a lot of fun. I don't know. My first instinct was to go with like a Will Ferrell or like a Brendan Fraser maybe.
Oh, wow.
But I just thought about it. I'm like, what if we had Marshawn Lynch at the wedding? Ooh. That would be awesome.
Yeah. As long as you guys don't drive her.
That's true.
You got to pick him up in that limo.
Yeah, that's
I'll make that happen.
Yeah, that's the key.
All right, Vicky. Oh.
I'm surprised you guys didn't pick this guy. He loves weddings. Tom Hanks.
It's a good call.
Well, I feel like I would have him do a speech. I mean, maybe something cool.
His speech would be pretty awesome.
Like whatever you want to do. Like, if you want to kind of dip into Toy Story action, you know, something about going and growing up and getting to the... whatever he wants. If he wants to cut the cake himself, he can do it. Whatever right. Tom wants.
Okay.
I want to change my answer.
What the hell? Yeah. You just gave us one.
I know, but I thought of the perfect one.
Uh-oh.
Who I want Chris Hemsworth there.
Oh,
I want Thor at my wedding.
Fat Thor or like buff Thor?
Buff Thor.
Are you guys getting shirtless together at some point?
We're going to party on the dance floor.
Oh, nice. I so much want Fat Thor there. Fat Thor, play video games with me.
Yeah. All right, Sarah.
Well, Joe, I definitely want to be at your wedding because, woo, if Thor's there, oh, count me in. See, I would love Thor at my wedding too, but let's get real. I wouldn't be able to even look at my fiance if Thor was there.
Yeah, that's bad.
Yeah, we can't have that.
Yeah, no. So I'm for sure going with Miley Cyrus.
Ooh. Oh,
dude, I'm going to have some entertainment there.
Now I'm excited to go to your wedding.
Right?
Oh, yeah.
Maybe there's going to be a wrecking ball or something. I don't know. I want the whole show.
Texas has a good one. I would have Gronk at my wedding. That party would be amazing. Oh, and he could bring Tom with him. The person said Tommy's
Gronk
dong.
Was a good call. That's a better call.
Gronk's a good pick.
Yeah, that's a better call.
Get married on the Gronk cruise.
Yeah.
So is it Tommy's dong to be at the wedding? Tommy's not Tommy Chong. Tommy's Tommy Lee, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, Tommy Lee, not Tom Hanks. Okay, cool. That'd be weird.
So is it Tom Hanks would be boring, though?
Really? I'm not a big partier anymore, so I'm okay. I don't need, like, a Gronk. Don't get me wrong. If Gronk showed up at my wedding, I wouldn't hate it, but I'm a pretty, like, chill she person nowadays. I feel like Tom Hanks is perfect.
She wants somebody to talk to her like Mr. Rogers. Hello, Vicky.
You know what?
It's a beautiful day at your wedding.
I'm going to go with Jesse the Body Ventura.
Oh, that'll be an S show, man.
At first, I'd have fun with him by just asking him all crazy wrestling questions, get a peek inside of that brain when it comes to wrestling and all that kind of stuff. Great character. And then I'd like bring him to like a table of people. Maybe I'd just like, you know, I want to punish them. And I'd just like, I'd ask some kind of conspiracy theorist question, just watch him go and walk away.
Oh, yeah.
Just be like, that's so, my entertainment for the night.
That's your troll wedding right there. He's just your guest to make all the other guests crazy.
And like the 20 people at the table or something, or 10 people at the table. Like, what? Steve White put Jesse the Body Ventura at a table. He won't stop talking about random things.
Why did you do
this? We're all wearing tinfoil helmets now, and it's very odd.
Well, I finally thought of mine.
Okay.
Shilliam Wattner.
Oh, come on.
He'd be fantastic.
You had all this time, and you still went with William Shatner.
You know who I thought of? I thought of Robert Downey Jr., even though he's in recovery. Still, I think, you know.
We have to worry about having an open bar.
Yeah, I mean, so I feel like that. I still feel like, I don't know, and maybe just because of all the characters he plays, but I feel like he would be fun. You know, he's in my demographic, so he wouldn't get too crazy. So I feel like that way. I feel like Robert Downey Jr., I think, would be probably fun to have at a wedding.
And you could just ask him all the things about Iron Man that you wanted to know.
Of course. You know, he's had a career, too. He's done other stuff, so I feel like he would have top of the line everything. Like he'd go, you know what? It's your wedding. We're going to get the top shelf everything.
So I said Dennis Rodman at my wedding. Oh, that would be a party.
Wow. That would be. Is he going to bring Kim Jong-un? I mean, or is he just going to come by himself?
Because he has no plus one.
Yeah. His plus one, you know, would be pretty. You'd be like, okay, this is going to be a party. Who's he going to bring? What crazy dictator is he going to bring to us?
He can't bring Michael Jordan if you don't give him a plus one, Steve.
That's a good point.
He's not going with Michael Jordan.
You don't know.
Yeah, sure. I bet Scottie Pippen before Jordan.
Oh, yeah, but you can't bring Scottie Pippen. He won't tip anybody, and that might, you know, people won't serve him. You got to remember
that's right.
That.
His nickname is No Tippin' Pippin.
No Tippin' Pippin, so really, yeah. You know, you got to be careful who you have at your wedding. You don't want to send the wrong message. Well, there you go. Shilliam Wattner.
Unbelievable.
Hey, speaking of Shilliam Wattner, how about this? We have audio for you to hear that will make both Led Zeppelin and Star Trek fans lose their minds. Hey, I'm one of those people. I might lose my mind. You're going to hear this at 8:17 on The Rock.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW.
At Gaia Herbs, we work ridiculously hard, so our herbs work ridiculously hard for you. That's why, instead of making gummies with refined sugar, we developed our own organic fruit-based formula. And why we handpick our leaves off our ginkgo trees to avoid whatever's on the ground. And why we test and retest everything in the lab for maximum potency. Because the harder we work, the harder our herbs work for you. Explore our herbs at GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. That's GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. Gaia Herbs, the hardest working herbs on earth.
99.9 KISW, The Rock of Seattle. A guy named Andy on YouTube did a mashup where he combined Led Zeppelin's Immigrant Song with the theme song to the original Star Trek series. So that's the original series with Kirk, Spock, and McCoy from the 60s. And the Immigrant Song from Led Zeppelin. Exactly. Yeah. Trying to think. I mean, I can't imagine this, so I why try to imagine it when you can hear it now?
Are you feeling it?
No.
No? Why? Is it bastardizing your Star Trek song?
No, not
with
at all.
The sweet drum licks of John Bonham?
I'm all for like, you know, fun mashups. I'm not too sure it goes well together. I mean, it's okay.
It sounds, honestly, that is one of those ones that I think just maybe you just like let that exist when you're stoned in your own apartment.
Yeah.
And it's kind of fun for you and your buddies, but I don't know if it needs to live forever.
There is a, you know, depending upon the version of the Star Trek theme, there is one where there's a woman that goes, oh, and so, you know, and then there's that, oh, 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 you know, from, and so I thought it was going to be more like that. You know?
Oh.
And so I had these expectations.
You set the expectations too high.
And it was just, yeah. I would like to hear somebody try it, in the version of like the screaming Led Zeppelin, but do the Star Trek theme. That would be interesting.
Well, maybe you should work on that.
Yeah, I'm going to, you know, I'll get back to you on that. I just, there's that time and effort thing. But yeah, that was, I don't hate it. I don't love it.
Oh, it's fun.
You know, if it's there, people, but you know, I'm not going to add it to a playlist or anything. Yeah. Well, I mean, nobody else in this show seems to be clamoring to say, this was the greatest thing I've ever heard.
No, I respect that someone probably put several minutes into making it, but that's about as far as
I don't even have respect for that. I'm sorry. Sometimes you just, you know, I think like 20 seconds in when you're doing it, you go, this is a dumb idea. I'm going to stop.
So not as good of a mashup as the jazz version of the Pearl Jam song.
Exactly.
Earlier.
Now, yeah. that was well worth the time and effort.
That
Do we have
effort.
That? Because in case people didn't hear it.
Oh, the pro. So yeah, it was about someone took Even Flow, the vocal only version. Like, so on YouTube, you can find like vocal only mixes or whatever, and they grabbed just Eddie Vedder's vocals and put it over like a jazzy version of Even Flow.
Do you think it's possible
that
Pearl Jam might just do a chip version of this? I mean, they have, you know how they are. They have fun
shows.
Mix
it up, yeah.
Yeah, you know, you never, I mean, I would love to see Eddie come out and do like a little, you know, just for the hell of it for 20 seconds.
I would love to know, like, you know, at what moment. I'm sure the guys in Pearl Jam have heard that. Maybe not, but
there's
probably a billion mashups out there. I can't imagine. Yeah. See, that would be me, though. While, like, our band's not touring or writing music, like, Steve, what have you been doing? What have you written any new songs for the band? Like, we're massive. Like, if we're in a massively successful band, I'm like, no, guys, I've just been on YouTube watching mashups and drum covers and other versions of our songs because I'm getting a massive kick out of that.
Yeah, I could see you doing that.
Because I think it's so cool when people, like, if you had a piece of art that you created and then somebody else was so, like, into that art that they just, or maybe not even know that, but whatever, and they decided to make their own version of it, that would be so interesting to me.
Yeah, I wonder, you know, I really, really wonder if a band has ever done that where they've really liked a mashup so much that they kind of just added to a, you know, to a set. I mean, you know, there's so many bands out there. You never know. And, you know, now it's about serving, like, really super serving the audience, you know, like how a podcast can super serve an audience. Will it be to the point where, you know, that's what they're doing? It's like, hey, you guys did this, so we're going to do it back for you. I don't know. I mean,
maybe like a band like Smash Mouth. I can see, or like Bare Naked Ladies.
What else are they going to do? I mean, yeah, well, see, now, Bare Naked Ladies, yes. They would be a band that would do it, and I'd be all for it. Smash Mouth, I think he'd be angry.
But I wouldn't see, like Radiohead or even Pearl Jam. Like, I don't feel like they play what they want to play. And then, I mean, there's certain songs, of course, they always throw in there, but I think they'd even be like, you know what, we don't feel like playing Yellow Lead Better tonight, and they just won't. And luckily, they have a fan base that's just like, bummed I didn't get to see them do Yellow Lead Better, but I got to see 3 hours of awesome Pearl Jam music.
How about this? How about Dave Grohl, yes or no?
Hmm.
I think he would.
It had to be pretty awesome.
Yeah. Well,
and I mean, made by a child. And then I think he would do it.
Yeah, from England.
That too.
Who's super talented. Yes. Then he's like, sure, I'm all on board. Oh, man.
Super case by case. I don't think every band would do the whole, hey, this mashup's doing really well. We should have some fun with that.
Yeah,
And then they'd be afraid that the guy who made the mashup's going to be like suing them.
Oh, hadn't thought about that. Well, you got to invite the guy. You got to make him part of it. If you do it, you got that way. You got everything covered. You're right.
I mean, the Foo Fighters, you know, obviously before Taylor passed, but when they were playing shows, they did Rickroll the fans. Remember when they brought out Rick Astley and did like the.
See, that's what I mean. I feel like he would have that kind of sense of humor, but
yeah.
How ironic. You know, Steve, you brought up a really interesting point. How about if you play somebody who basically took your music, used it without your permission, and then you decide, oh, that's fun, and you play it on stage and you get sued by that guy? That would be the biggest irony ever.
It's like the person who breaks into your home and then gets hurt because they broke into your home sues you, and somehow that becomes a lawsuit. It's almost not the same, obviously, but you know
that
what I mean.
It's the American way. That's how to succeed in this country.
It's like, I stole something from you, turned it into something else. Yeah. You stole it back. I want my money.
Yeah. How dare you play the song I stole from you? That is horrible. Oh, that's awesome. There's this high school math teacher in L.A. Who would ride 6 miles on a scooter to work every day. And
to be honest, when I first saw this story, I thought like one of those Razor scooters. I was like, poor guy. Then I realized, oh, yeah, this actual like motorized scooter.
Well, yeah. I mean, didn't Miles used to ride a scooter?
I think he still might.
Yeah.
Miles and I think Brian Castle, too.
Castle as well. And I know Ted had a scooter. I don't know if he still has one.
So here's. I don't want to rain on the parade of this story, but I think those guys lived about 6 miles at least, didn't they, on their scooter? I mean, they traveled at least 6 miles to get here. So, and they enjoyed it.
So like, maybe the story would be better if it was a Razor scooter.
Yeah, I think you're right. But again, we just know people that do ride scooters to work and enjoy it and feel like they're actually making a, you know, they're reducing their carbon footprint. So they're actually happy. But these kids took a look at it like, oh, this poor guy.
Maybe it was a crappy scooter and he was always complaining about it.
And the roads aren't paved really well.
Yeah.
Just a bumpy ride.
All right. It's, you know what? Either way, I'm not sure what happened here, except the kids were like, you know what? We got to do something. We got to do something for this teacher. So they raised money and got him a brand new car. And his name is Julio Castro. And here's the moment where he opened up a piñata, revealing keys to the car
That's awesome.
That his students had bought him. I mean, yeah, piñatas are cool.
Turkeys?
Josh, why? Why, Josh?
How's it going?
Turkeys?
Oh, this is actually your car.
What? Wow. I'd like to know, do we know the kind of car they got him?
Yeah, I can't. A navy blue Mazda sedan.
Oh.
With complete black leather seats. And whoa, apparently, like, they started raising money and some businesses also chipped in some cash. Like, they raised a good chunk of change to where not only did they give him a car, but I think I read something like he's got like enough money they gave him for like a year of free gas or something along those lines.
Oh, he's going to need that. That's actually really valuable.
Yeah, that might be better
than
the car itself.
They were thinking ahead, those kids. How'd they get him a car so quick? I mean, it's hard to get a car. Good for them. They figured that out, too, because you can't even get a car these days.
Maybe one of the dads of the kids owns a dealership.
Oh.
I don't know. I don't know why all of a sudden they need to be in cahoots like it's the mafia to get a car.
Hey, Jimmy. Yeah, your dad's got a dealership. Let's talk.
What a cool moment. He must be a cool teacher.
I hope he likes it. Because, again, you know, if he really didn't...
He looks super pumped. He got a free car.
All right, yeah. I mean, I would sell it if I was a scooter guy. I'd be like, I'm pretty happy with my scooter, but thanks for the car and the free gas.
He did say now he'll be able to drop his kids off every morning. You can't really take kids on a scooter.
Sure you can. One on each lap.
Okay, but what does that say about the school system? I mean, I think it's great that the kids did this, but how about your teacher can't afford a car? I mean, I don't know what he's getting paid, but or is this a scam? I wonder if he's
jumping at conclusions left and right. He's probably a mobster. You're right.
Yeah. Right, exactly.
What if he's like, you know, what if he's got like, he gets a car every year and now he leaves the school district, goes to a new school district and says, and just does that sob story on the scooter. And then those kids get him a car. And this guy's getting cars all over the place. We don't even know.
No, he must be an awesome guy for kids to actually go out of the way to do something. Because most kids are pretty ambivalent or straight up are just jerks to their teachers for no reason other than they're teenagers.
And on top of it, not only is he must be a cool teacher, he's a math teacher. Like math teachers when I was growing up, they sucked.
He's not getting a car.
And it had nothing to do with them as human beings. It was just that they were teaching me something that I hated. And it was never a fun subject to be part. So the fact that like he's endeared himself so much to those kids as a math teacher, I don't know why, but that to me makes it even more impressive.
I can't believe he's that good of a guy. There are no good math teachers. They're all very boring and they all teach you horrible stuff. Like the English teachers
like
and
fractions.
The history teacher. Yeah, I hate that.
How dare they?
I mean, he's probably a nice person, but I'm sorry. He's evil because of what he's forced to teach. That's what it is. I wouldn't get him a car. You know, that's it. It's over. I still think he's a scam artist.
Well, fortunately, you're never going to have this problem, BJ. A group of children trying to raise enough money to buy you a car.
Yeah, you know what? You're right. That first of all, you'd wonder, like, why are these group of children buying you anything? What is going on? You'll probably have me arrested if a group of children just decided to give me a car.
I couldn't even imagine what that would be like if, like, all of a sudden, like, I came here to work and you guys were all like, we noticed that your car is getting up there in mileage, Steve, and you got to get this replaced, that replaced. We all decided to raise some money, and he's right. I can't even finish the sentence.
There's no way. I'm sorry.
You already shot it down.
Yeah, it's just like, you know what? Sorry. You know, find a way to get your kid, put like a sidecar on your scooter, do something. But, you know, we're out.
Birthday's a couple months away.
Oh, yeah.
October.
Oh, yeah.
You got plenty of time to raise
money. I'm going to get you a nice used lottery ticket. You know what I mean? That's what I'm thinking of. There you go, buddy.
I saw that some guy told his wife, I think she was on vacation. He's like, hey, if I call you, that means we won the lottery. And then he called her, and she's like, well, you called me because we won the lottery? He goes, yeah, we won $200,000 in the lottery. I was like, that's such a great story.
Oh, so it really was true.
Yeah, he actually did call his wife to tell him. Because she picked up the phone, apparently. I was like, what are you calling me to tell me? Like, joking and making fun of him. He's like, actually, yeah, I'm calling because we did win. And granted, not millions, but still a couple $100,000.
That's nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, but here's the problem. Would I tell her when she's on vacation when it's only $200,000? Because you know what I would do? If you called me and told me, if Kathy called me and said, hey, you know what, we went to I'm spending money, and I might spend it all accidentally.
Oh, yeah, like I'm on vacation, and like Sid, I'm not with Sid, and she's like, hey, we just won $200,000. I'm like, don't watch our bank statements for the next couple of hours because I'm going crazy.
Yeah, I don't think that would be a wise idea for me to know that info.
Yeah, I guess she was in Virginia, and she said the husband joked, he's like, yeah, I'll call you if we win the lottery. And then she got the call, and it was $227,000. And it took him a bit to convince her that it wasn't a joke.
And after taxes, they got $20.
That's bad.
Really a great deal. America.
Yeah, you can buy one combo meal at a fast food place.
Yeah, I mean, that's good money right there. Good for them, man. Oh, he's a Washington Nationals fan, too. We ought to thank him for all the wins. Thanks, buddy. Yeah. on Friday. Jeez. Steve did get this one right.
How many quarters make up $15?
60.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Wow.
Definitely 60.
Mickey, I was with you. I'm like, I mean, how did he get that, like, first guess like that?
Right?
Look, four quarters and a dollar.
Yeah, okay. Yeah,
you do the rest.
You know what?
I can't.
You're so impressed. You're so impressive. We're going to buy you a car, math man.
I got it all down pat, man. Yeah. It was that math teacher that helped me with it.
That's what it was. Okay. Hey, you want a shot at beating Steve? You got it. 206-421-ROCK. We're playing Beat Migs at 847 on The Rock.
Today's podcast was brought to you by Travis Gagne, bankruptcy attorney. He's here right now and has agreed to answer more of your questions about bankruptcy. Here's a question from a listener. My house is currently in foreclosure. I've stopped making payments. What can I do to save my house?
If you're already in foreclosure behind on your mortgage, you can stop the foreclosure by filing a bankruptcy. There's different types of bankruptcy. Chapter 13 can help you catch up on your house payments if you're behind. It would mean that you'd have to start making your house payments again and catch up on the amount that you're behind over 5 years. You could also take off or strip off your second mortgage, which would help you to reduce your housing payment every month, especially once you're done with the plan and done catching up on your first mortgage. We could also try to buy you some time by filing a Chapter 13 case. Filing a Chapter 13 would definitely stop your foreclosure.
Thanks, Travis. If you have more questions about bankruptcy, you can reach out to Travis anytime at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com. And thanks for listening.
At Gaia Herbs, we work ridiculously hard, so our herbs work ridiculously hard for you. That's why, instead of making gummies with refined sugar, we developed our own organic fruit-based formula. And why we handpick our leaves off our ginkgo trees to avoid whatever's on the ground. And why we test and retest everything in the lab for maximum potency. Because the harder we work, the harder our herbs work for you. Explore our herbs at GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. That's GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. Gaia Herbs, the hardest working herbs on earth. At Gaia Herbs, we work ridiculously hard, so our herbs work ridiculously hard for you. That's why, instead of making gummies with refined sugar, we developed our own organic fruit-based formula. And why we handpick our leaves off our ginkgo trees to avoid whatever's on the ground. And why we test and retest everything in the lab for maximum potency. Because the harder we work, the harder our herbs work for you. Explore our herbs at GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. That's GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. Gaia Herbs, the hardest working herbs on earth.
Hey, this is BJ. Thanks for listening to our show's podcast. If you're a fan of all things geeky, you should check out my other podcast, BJ Shea's Geek Nation. We have new episodes every day, and you can check it out at BJGeekNation.com.
Your home is going into foreclosure, and you feel like a financial wreck. You don't know where to turn for accurate information. I'm bankruptcy attorney Travis Gagne. Let's talk about some legal options. If we work quickly, we can propose a plan to save your home, modify the loan, or in many cases, even eliminate your second mortgage. The consultation is free. I've helped hundreds of people just like you make informed decisions about whether to save their home or exit it on a reasonable, organized timeline. The chapter you choose sets the tone for the next chapter of your life. Please contact me today at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com.
99.9 KISW, The Rock of Seattle. Can't believe it's here, man. Pain in the Grass this weekend at the White River Amphitheater. Three big days, Labor Day weekend. Oh, man, the shows.
Looking like the weather's going to be great, too. Perfect wet outside. Enjoy some sweet sounds of Incubus, Bush, Alice in Chains, Breaking Benjamin, not Breaking Bad, like I mentioned earlier this morning. I didn't even catch
did you
that.
Say, I totally missed that myself.
I missed until the text was like, Walter, dude, Breaking Bad's performing?
Wow. Jesse
Queen Drake.
Is going to be there.
The Glorious Sons. Bunch of other great bands, Sammy Hagar. It's going to be a great time all weekend long. We're all going to be there hanging out with all the Rockaholics. It's so nice that we're going to get to do this again.
Yeah, and don't forget the BJ and Migs private party that's happening with the first ever BJ and Migs Weenie Toss. Get those tickets before they sell out. You want info, you know where to go. KISW.com.
Let's play B Migs.
It's time to play the game.
Guys, ready for round two of Beat Migs today?
Yeah, it was a close one. I'm hoping I get a song.
I don't know. As long as Sarah's in the other room, she's been my heater. I've yet to lose with Sarah hanging out in the other room.
Yeah.
When Joe was in there, I lost all the time.
I think the contestants see me to go back in there is what needs to happen.
Yeah.
I don't agree with that.
I feel like we need to test it out. So we'll see if you can beat Chris from Roy. Chris, are you there?
There he is. Hold on. There he is. Yes,
ma'am.
Ma'am. So let's test this theory. Steve, get out of here.
Okay, bye.
For those playing at home, Chris has 60 seconds to answer 10 questions. You can pass all you want, but you only get 3 guesses per question. Are you ready?
Let's do it.
What is Santa Claus most commonly called in Britain?
Saint Nick?
No.
Kris Kringle?
Nope.
Father Christmas?
Yeah. How many times did Ross Geller marry and divorce on the sitcom Friends?
Twice?
No.
3 times?
Yes. What city is home to the University of Oregon?
Medford?
No.
Salem?
Nope.
Portland?
Nope. How many teeth on average does the adult human have? Or they're supposed to
32.
Have?
32.
Yes. What is the evil fairy's name in Sleeping Beauty?
Maleficent.
Yes. The standard dartboard is divided into how many numbered sections?
20.
Correct. What is the only bird to be honored by its own year on the Chinese calendar?
Luther.
Yes. What is the most shoplifted book?
The Bible.
Yeah. What was Alf's girlfriend from Melmac's name?
Oh, my God. Linda.
No. Oh. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Hopefully that's not the difference maker.
I don't know. I feel like we might not get some of the other ones.
All right, because he should know that one.
Yeah. I mean, if he's truly a fan like he says he is, I'll be very disappointed if he doesn't.
I think it's his favorite show ever. That's the problem. The problem is that is his favorite show ever, and that, well, that's just him.
All right.
We're talking about Small Wonder?
Yes.
Oh, nice. No. I mean, you have a show you like even better than that.
Alf?
Maybe. Maybe not.
Uh-oh. That okay.
Good question.
You ready, Steve?
Ah, yes!
What is
how bad is it that I was right? Right, Vicky? That I knew?
Well, shush. What is Santa Claus more commonly known as in Britain?
Kris Kringle.
No.
Santa Claus.
No.
Hi, Santy.
Jolly Saint Nick.
No. How many times did Ross Geller marry and divorce on the sitcom Friends?
Twice.
No.
3 times.
Yes. What city is home to the University of Oregon?
Eugene.
Yes. How many teeth on average does an adult human have?
32.
Yes. What is the evil fairy's name in Sleeping Beauty?
Ferryman.
No.
Evil Lady.
No.
Cruella DeVille.
No.
Oh.
The standard dartboard is divided into how many numbered sections?
3.
No.
4.
No.
5.
No.
Damn it.
What is the only bird to be honored by its own year on the Chinese calendar?
Pigeon.
No.
Parrot.
No.
Cockadoo.
No.
Oh.
What is the most shoplifted book?
The Bible.
Yes. What was Alf's girlfriend from Melmac's name?
Alice.
No.
Crap. I don't remember.
Oh, no.
Nancy.
No.
Alfie.
No.
Wow.
1, 2, 3, 4. You lose 7-4.
Ooh, great game, Gladys. Chris.
No.
Yeah. Oh, thanks,
Bertha.
No, yeah. But it kind of reminds me of that.
Beatrice.
Nice job, Chris. Thank you, buddy.
Loser.
Oh, yeah. You are, Steve. Hate to say it, but...
Wah.
Where do you keep your casserole dishes?
Why?
The cat won't fit in the toaster.
I forgot he even had a girlfriend. I mean, he was very promiscuous with all those cats he wanted to eat.
Had to be the later seasons, right? You know, maybe when it's starting to jump the shark, that show.
I don't think so. It probably was there since day one, BJ. I don't remember.
I don't remember a girlfriend at all. And I remember a little bit about that show. I don't remember a girl.
I was a kid when I watched it. I remember all these little details. I remember Alf. He was an alien life form. And that's as good as it's going to get.
Yeah, you weren't as geeky about it, because I was a kid when Star Trek was on, and I remember a lot of stuff. Of course, I watched every episode multiple times. Well, I thought you were going to get that. I am very happy. Got my song. That's awesome. Anybody know the girlfriend's name?
No, I didn't expect anybody to. Rhonda.
Rhonda. She's from Planet Melmac as well?
Mm-hmm.
I did not expect it to be like a Rhonda. That is so weird.
Like, why is her name Rhonda and his name is just Alf?
Mm.
And it's just, it's not even really his name. He's just an alien life form. So they called him Alf.
It's your favorite show. You should know.
I don't really know. To be honest with you. I went on Wikipedia just because I got like a little obsessive. And I did not realize that the guy who created the character, he created the puppet to annoy his friends and family originally.
Well, he did a good job because it annoyed the hell out of me across America.
And then he like tried to show it to a bunch of people and everyone was like, yeah, no, I'm not going to make it happen. And eventually that happened.
Wow. It turned out to be a relatively successful show, but man, the amount of rejections when it said, no, we're not doing a show bait. What? And then somebody was high enough to go, yeah, let's do it.
And I do love that they also had, to avoid wear and tear on the main Alf puppet, they had another version of Alf, but they called it Ralph for a rehearsal alien life form or repulsive alien life form. And that version of Alf would like say mean and awful things during the rehearsals.
Okay, that's brilliant. All right, you did not get what is Santa Claus more commonly known as in Britain, but Chris did. It's Father Christmas.
We sang that song.
Father Christmas.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I didn't know that was why they... I just thought it was just a song.
That's why the Kinks... Because that's what the Kinks call Santa Claus over in England.
You killed me, Steve. I thought you said Panty Claus.
Oh, gosh.
Oh, I said Santa Claus.
Like, that is a naughty clause.
That is a different kind of Santa.
Ho, ho, ho. It's Panty Claus.
You didn't get the evil fairy's name in Sleeping Beauty, but Chris also did get that one, Maleficent. They had like a bunch of other standalone movies.
Yeah,
yes.
She had her own movie. She was moving out.
And thanks, Texas. You're right. Al's name was Gordon.
Gordon Shumway. God, yes.
I forgot about that.
Oh, you mean like his name on the show?
Yeah.
Oh,
no, his real life name, BJ.
Yeah, okay. Well, I wasn't, I don't know. You know, who knows if Alf decided to have a real life.
And only bird to be honored by its own year on the Chinese calendar.
Rooster.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Oh, damn it. Yep, you really... I don't think Sarah's not your heater anymore, man.
Yeah, what happened? This was supposed to be your time to shine.
It was. I let you down, Sarah. I'm sorry.
I hella up-talked you in this room.
I know. You had me all pumped up and ready to go, and I come in here and I drop the ball.
You just got to slap him in the chest.
And Sarah, his go-to TV show, nothing.
I know.
Oh, man.
So it's bad. Poetic, huh? Yeah. All fell apart because of Alf.
Oh, well. It is time... For you. Yes, your time. Listeners on the Loose, where you pick the topic, you guide the show. 206-421-ROCK. Text us at 77999. We got your calls. We got your texts. We'll take those at 917 on The Rock.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW.
99.9 KISW, The Rock of Seattle. It's Listeners on the Loose. You pick the topic. You got the show. 206-421-ROCK. Text us at 77999. This is a simple concept. You call in and you follow Steve's rule.
It's a simple rule, BJ. Just show some energy and bring it. Otherwise, we'll gong you. And then we're going to have to say goodbye to you.
Goodbye, old friend.
206-421-ROCK. Text us at 77999.
Got a few texts about this. I think the people are just trying to get under our skin about our bitter ex, Russell Wilson. Did you guys see what Russell Wilson had to say about the Seahawks? That he doesn't have to carry the Broncos?
Oh, what?
I'd love to have been able to hear the context of it all.
Me too.
Because apparently it was at a kickoff luncheon. And he said one of the things that appealed him to joining Denver and being on the Broncos is that he wouldn't have to carry the team on his shoulders alone. He didn't say that he was carrying the Seahawks, but people are like being like, is that like kind of a not so subtle shot at the team? Because, you know, obviously the last few years, it seems like they expected him to pull some miracles out of his, you know, where ski. But I wasn't too worked up about that because I think in the same luncheon, he had a lot of love for the Seahawks as well. But, you know, when you take something like that, put it up into a headline, it becomes a story.
Well, I think, you know, boy, that's we got to keep that question. We should ask that when we talk to Mitch Levy soon. Of course, you know, Mitch Unfiltered coming back to us for the whole football season. Because is it fair to even entertain that thought? So, yes, I can be bitter. Like, why are you going to, is it a shot? But then again, is it a fair shot? Was he kind of expected to do too much considering that they didn't really get a whole lot around him to protect him, you know? Maybe they thought he should run around more. I don't know. It's a very interesting statement.
It could also be, and I mean, obviously, unless you're in his brain, which I don't know if I really want to be in, because Seems a lot there.
I don't know, but it seems like, you know, a lot lately. I mean, you wake up, your brain wakes up next to Ciara every day. That's not a bad brain situation.
Could it also be something along the lines of him just being like, of the teams that I decided to go with, that was the team that was most appealing to me, because the other teams that were maybe a potential, I'd have to be the guy that's carrying the team. Whereas I'm going to Denver, I got more options. It's a really solid team from offense to defense, and I didn't feel that. You know what I mean? Like, it could be taken many ways.
Well, no doubt about it. Denver, I could be wrong, but I think Denver's a little ahead of us. They look like they could make the playoffs, even though their division's tough.
And also, I mean, do you think he wants to go down that road? I mean, because there's like a lot of former players and teammates that aren't necessarily known for being very quiet that would probably have a lot to say in response to that. I'm thinking about guys like, you know, like the Doug Baldwins, the Richard Shermans, the Michael Bennett's. Like, these are guys that if he was taking a shot at, like, the Seahawks and saying, I had to carry the Seahawks, I think they have a lot to say.
I don't think it was about the past.
That's true.
I think it's recent.
Yeah.
I really think it's recent, because you're right. Because you could argue the Legion of Boom really carried the team when we won the Super Bowl, that's for sure. So I don't think we had to worry. Russell wasn't doing any carrying. I mean, he had some great stuff, but he also had Marshawn. I feel like it's recently. And no fault. I don't think there's any fault to anybody, except you could argue that they just, you know, they really could have done better with the offensive line, but that just wasn't where they were going. They were, you know, they decided to put their money into other stuff.
Yeah.
You know, that's it. That's the only thing I could think of where they were like, no, you know what? You'll figure it out like you always figure it out, running around, and we don't have to protect you, and we don't have to, you know, whatever. Get you the best of the best all the time in certain positions.
And I always look for any reason that to crap all over Russell Wilson nowadays. But of all the things that one didn't really like get under my skin as much as I think it did other Seahawk fans.
And it was, you know, I mean, I feel like the guy has a right to say
he's kissing ass of the Broncos.
Yeah, well, there's that.
And the fans.
He very rarely says negative stuff, but I think the way he tells the truth is in vagaries and sort of platitudes, so that even a negative thing doesn't seem negative. But I feel like that was a shot. I do.
All right, so I want to talk about Ichiro. They said, hey, I'm very happy to share with you guys that I got my Ichiro Hall of Fame bobblehead yesterday.
Looks sweet.
It was a legendary crowd, but we were able to make it in the gate in time. Anyone catch a game? Yeah, because I think it was like the first 20,000. These games were practiced, if not sold out. They were all, I know Saturday was sold out, but I think all the other ones were pretty close to sellouts if they weren't.
It's a fun time to be a baseball fan around here. And of course, and for Ichiro, I mean, really, what a way to be honored while the team is good. You know, it's nice to come back while there's excitement. The team is good. Also, I mean, I'm sure it's happened, but I don't remember anybody coming back to be honored for anything who is in full uniform and also would look good in full uniform. He is amazing. Most players who have been that away from the game as long as him, you know, they get a little belly. They're a little out of shape.
No, he's in great shape.
And they don't usually, they'll wear a jersey, but they'll have a pair of jeans on or something. He's in full uniform for that. And, you know, when he's catching the pitch from Ichiro Girl, I was just impressed. And he looks man.
What if that's what he wears all the time? Like, he goes out to dinner with his wife.
So he's always walking around.
Walking his dogs. Had a nice little message for him on Saturday. Like, he's just out in the neighborhood. And they're like, oh, there's Ichiro. He's wearing his jersey and his pants and his socks.
Yeah,
he looks so young. And then when he did the speech, though, without the hat on, not that he looked old, but, like, that's when you're like, okay, the hat definitely on makes him look like he's, like, 10 years younger.
And yeah, we forget that he also joined us as, you know, a seasoned ball player. He wasn't a rookie, he wasn't of rookie age. So I don't know how old Ichiro is. Is he in his mid 40s, basically, or maybe
48 years old?
48 years old. Well, he looks tremendous for 48 years old.
Did you see the bobblehead?
I did.
Oh, that's sweet.
Yeah, it's sweet.
Yeah, it's got all his gold gloves stacked up. It's got like all of his awards. He's holding basically all of his awards.
Yeah. Yeah, he was, and a super disciplined player. You know, there was a guy that I think, you know, look, he had talent, but because of his discipline, because of his dedication, made himself a Hall of Famer, you know, with his talent. A lot of guys have talent in the world, but they don't put the work in and never get to be as great as they could be. Ichiro is definitely an example of that, you know, the discipline and the work ethic. And even to this day, I'm sure he's probably pretty disciplined and you know, does what he does to stay in that shape.
Well, he might be able to play for the Mariners and have a better batting average than some of the players they're paying skillions of dollars to.
You know, seriously, he's probably looking around going, you know what, I could bat 195.
Right.
I could do that. I mean, in a heartbeat, he probably could bat 220.
And not be the worst player on the team.
No, and you've got defense. Like, he probably still could gun somebody out. I mean, yeah, it's not crazy. Not crazy at all. Sorry, I think I'd take him.
All right, so that's a question. It has nothing to do with sports.
Okay.
Says, good morning, everyone. I need some help and maybe some support. I've been meaning to quit nicotine for years, but I really should now that my second kid is on the way. Any advice for getting over an addiction?
Oh, boy.
I don't think any of us are smokers. Is anyone on our show? Sarah, no.
No.
Nobody here is a cigarette smoker, ever.
That
ever.
Is pretty amazing.
Have you ever had one cigarette?
I took a puff out of, like, an ex-boyfriend's cigarette once.
Yeah.
And that was it. Ever in my life.
I only did one puff as well, and it's because we're all on mushrooms, and everyone else was smoking cigarettes when I was younger. And I was like, well, I don't want to break the chain. I don't know what that chain was, BJ, but I didn't want to break it.
Didn't want to break it, man.
Everyone else was smoking a cigarette, so I was like, I'll have a puff just to keep things going.
I don't even think I did it right. Are you supposed to, like, inhale it? Because I just, like, left it in my mouth and, like, kind of blew it out because I thought that's what you're supposed to do. But I guess
cigarette.
Not, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know what I did with that cigarette, to be honest with you. But
yeah.
I've never had any interest. I feel for anyone trying to quit. I hear it's an awful experience.
Well, the bottom line is this, is your body becomes addicted to, like, it needs the stuff, and you'll have to go through detox like any. But here's the thing. Why did you start smoking in the first place? And because a lot of people, it's a de-stressor. You mm-hmm. see, and that's why cigarettes were so popular back in the day, is that, you know, people going through, like, world wars and stuff, and they would go out and take a smoke break just because it was an effing stress ball to be, like, a human being. And at least in this country. So it's tough to, what are you going to do to replace that? I remember a buddy of mine quit smoking, decided to stop drinking, and also to lose weight all at the same time. And I'm like, dude, what are you going to replace, like, all that with? Because you know, your brain needed all that to sort of deal with life. And what are you going to do to deal with life? And that, you see that a lot on a lot of those addiction shows. There's counseling that goes along with also getting you off the stuff. So that's the big one. You know, your mind is going to be the biggest enemy for you, is like, what are you going to do to deal with what the cigarettes used to help you deal with, or whatever, or however you're taking your nicotine?
Just find something else to put in your mouth.
Mm-hmm. Well, hey, for some of us.
But Sarah just gave me a look and nodded yes.
Yeah. Yes, yeah. I think so. I was going to suggest lollipop.
Yeah.
Okay, that's
toothpicks.
Right? I really don't want to have this conversation.
One texter said I'd try Chantix. I don't know. I guess that might be something to help.
I think it's the gum.
Okay, I did that. I haven't smoked a cigarette for 5 years. Another person used ZYN for quitting smoking. It's a nicotine pouch, and it worked for them. Someone read a book by Alan Carr and helped them quit nicotine.
Hmm. Yeah, I that's really good for the physicality of it all, but then there's also the mentality. So if you can handle both, and there's plenty of people out there, I think, that probably specialize in that. Sometimes people use hypnosis. So good luck to you, man. It's one of the toughest addictions to quit. I mean, that industry was like, they had super brilliant scientists finding a way to come up with the perfect concoction to get you to continue to buy their product. And it was all about nicotine and the right mixture, man.
I'm just glad that. I mean, because my mom was a master smoker. I think by my mom being a smoker, and this is back in the day of when cigarettes, she was smoking a cigarette and all the windows were closed in the house. It was just like, your house was a cigarette. I hated it so much. I hated my mom was smoking cigarettes too because of the health reasons. You know, I want my mom to live forever, but like, that was a big part of it too, was just like, never once did I ever even can entertain the idea that smoking cigarettes would be a good idea, because I was just so annoyed and I hated it in my household.
Which is interesting, because a lot of my friends in high school, when we were teenagers, they picked up smoking because their parents smoked at home. So that was good on you that you had.
Thank goodness.
Yeah, you didn't do it.
It hit me the same way, Steve. I was so disgusted by it because everybody in my family smoked, and all the walls were this disgusting yellow, brownish, orange color, and they're supposed to be white.
Oh, dude, for real. Like, the ceilings, we had to paint them every once in a while, and it's just like, whoa, that's what a white ceiling looks like. I thought we just bought off-white paint.
Yeah,
didn't realize.
You could tell who the smokers. Everybody had the same off-white color to their walls, man.
No, seriously, if you want to pass the time, if you YouTube or even on Facebook, there are cleaning videos of, like, smokers' houses of 20 years of smoking indoors. And when they steam clean the walls, the amount of just yellow dripping down.
I can't imagine.
It is both disgusting and satisfying to watch.
It's like an R. Kelly video. You don't want to see it.
All right.
Yeah, you really don't
want to. Yeah, I'm never going to watch this now. That's
good. No, I would, I really wouldn't. Yeah. You don't want to see all the yellow dripping down, Steve. You really don't. It is Listeners on the Loose, where you pick the topic, you guide the show. 206-421-ROCK. Text us at 77999. More of your calls and more of your texts at 934 on The Rock.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW.
At Gaia Herbs, we work ridiculously hard, so our herbs work ridiculously hard for you. That's why, instead of making gummies with refined sugar, we developed our own organic fruit-based formula. And why we handpick our leaves off our ginkgo trees to avoid whatever's on the ground. And why we test and retest everything in the lab for maximum potency. Because the harder we work, the harder our herbs work for you. Explore our herbs at GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. That's GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. Gaia Herbs, the hardest working herbs on earth.
99.9 KISW, The Rock of Seattle. It's Listeners on the Loose. You pick the topic, you guide the show. 206-421-ROCK. Text us at 77999.
Someone texted and said, Migs, it was great seeing you at the Lowry at Bar yesterday. Nice to meet you. It was awesome. I met a lot of rockaholics yesterday at the White Center block party. It was a big block. They off like a couple of blocks, and they just have music going, and they had just all this crazy food. But then they also Defy Wrestling put on a wrestling show outside the Lariat Bar, which is a wrestling-themed bar in White Center, which is awesome. It's right by Drunky Two Shoes. Very cool spot. And it was just surreal to be wrestling outside, especially because across right behind the ring, right, depending on where you're looking, there's this, I don't know, it was like a cream puff store or pastry store.
Like that.
But it was called like something panda. There's a giant panda head on the store. So, and then some of the pictures, there's just this giant panda behind me, which I thought was like one of the funniest things.
Makes me think that might be like an Asian bakery.
Yes, definitely.
Oh, that's awesome.
Puffy
that's
Pandy.
Puffy Pandy.
Oh, Puffy
Shout
Pandy.
Shout out to Puffy Pandy.
I'm all in. You know what? Here, would that bring me to Puffy Pandy.
Yeah, look
Pandy
at there.
Right
that's
now.
The storefront right there.
Dude, that is awesome. Look at that giant panda.
Yeah, so that was in the background as we're having our matches. So every time I was wrestling, I was just having a great, just chuckling because I'd see this giant panda bear.
Oh, that's great. Oh, look at you with the panda.
Yeah.
That's a great picture.
Yeah,
wow.
I chose to wear my white tights to match the panda.
Dude, outside wrestling, how did you do that?
Dude, it was good to see Joe Dredd and Healy. They came out because they live right by there, so word got to them that it was there. So they came out. That was awesome to see them there. Oh, dude, it was like 80 degrees, sun beating down.
Whoa.
And it's just a sweat fest.
I don't even know if I want to be with another human in a ring with all the sweat flying.
Oh, yeah. And then it's, so from the best part was, it's gone. A lot of kids there. Super awesome, right? There's this cute kid. He's like, hey. And so I go over to him. He's like, can you give this pin to whoever loses your match? I was like, sure. So I grab the pin and then I walk away and I look at the pin on the other side. It's like one of those like old school, like, you know, pins, buttons. Mm-hmm. And it's got a big rainbow. And underneath the rainbow, it just says F U.
Oh,
fully spelled out.
That's fantastic.
This kid was like six, maybe seven
that
years
is
old.
Unbelievable. What are you bringing the children to?
I don't know. But I was like, you know, in my head, I'm like, don't curse. Because I was like, you know, like during the match, like, don't curse. There's children here. First child I interact with gives me a pin that basically says F U.
What do the people do if they know you and they're in a public setting where, you know, they know there are kids and they want to be respectful? How do they hate you? Because normally the F word is part of hating you when you wrestle.
Well, fortunately at Defy, people, I'm on the good side. I'm not an evil man.
Oh, you're a good guy on Defy.
But there's been some situations where I've been in like an all ages show where kids are probably saying the worst stuff, honestly. But some are trying to be cool and say screw Steve Migs instead of F Steve Migs.
Oh, that's nice of them.
Or boo Steve Migs, I've heard too. That was kind of funny. But the kids are still saying the F word.
Yeah, they are.
I think the parents are trying, but the kids are. I mean, the kid gave me a button that said F U.
Yeah,
with a rainbow on it. I don't even know where the button went, though.
I think the train has left the station when it comes to cussing. I think us adults have lost the battle, and maybe we need to rethink the whole idea of what's good and bad anymore with words.
But I think that in a weird way, that button came back to bite me because at the end of the match, I don't know how. I think I might have landed on the button because I put it kind of on the side. And afterwards, like, I'm like, the match is over, and everyone's like, your back is bleeding. And I sliced my back. I don't even know how. Because I think it might have been from that damn button.
Oh,
Oh, damn, dude.
So kids want to hug you. I'm like, I don't want to be rude. Don't hug me because you might grab some blood. Oh. It was just a weird thing.
Oh, that kid. He got you.
And I ended up losing. So, I mean, basically, he told me, F you to
so
me.
So he kind of really came up to you in a kind way, said, you're going to need this because you're going to lose.
Well, I hope he was hoping I wasn't losing.
I feel like he must have known something.
But I want to know where he got that button.
Yeah. That's a great button. It's a rainbow with the old F-bomb on there.
I could not stop laughing, dude. That's great. I just grabbed it. I didn't even bother to look at first. And then I look at it, I'm like, you have got to be kidding me. This button says F you.
I'll tell you right now, there's nothing more attractive than a sweaty, bloody man on a hot day.
Thank
Good
you.
Good for you. Yeah.
That's pretty much how it is in White Center, man.
That's how you're living. You know what I mean? You know what? Block Party Steve. He's going down there sweating and bleeding for the people.
I said it before. Highly recommend if you're a wrestling fan. Even if you're not, like, it's just a cool vibe in there because it's kind of got like a cool, like, you know, dark, old school vibe to the bar, but it's all wrestling memorabilia in there, and it's called the Lariat Bar in White Center.
Oh, I thought you were going to tell
great
me.
Great bartenders. Yes. Everyone there is awesome.
I thought you said go to Puffy Panda because I'm 100% behind
it. It's right across the street from it,
it's
BJ.
It's right over there. Hey.
You get some drinks. You cross the street, you get some cream puffs.
All right.
And then whenever they open it up again, you get some crawfish at the crawfish place right there, too.
Oh, well, it's not open yet, though?
I don't know. It wasn't open during...
Oh, that's not the show. They got to figure that out. Come on, crawfish people.
Somebody want to know if any of us watched Samaritan Man over the weekend.
Oh, I totally forgot about that movie.
I didn't get to watch it between weddings and wrestling. I didn't have a chance. But according to this text, I don't know if I want to, BJ.
Oh, really?
Say it was awesome to see Sly on the screen again, and it's impressive he could still do action movies. But that movie sucked.
Oh, boy. Well, I guess I'm not going to be watching it. I mean, even though it's free, I still may
I'll
not
probably still watch it.
All right, well, I need to hear your impression first.
I saw a trailer for it over the weekend, and in the trailer, he gets hit by a car in front of the kid.
Yeah.
And the kids ask him, when are you going to come back? And all I could think when he was on the ground was, it's not about how hard you get hit.
Oh, like the Rocky Six speech.
Yeah.
Yes.
After getting hit by a car. Like, this is going to the extreme level.
Yeah, that trailer. I saw that trailer too, Joe, and that's why I had so much hope for the movie, but no.
Well, apparently the reviewers don't like it because it got 38% on Rotten Tomatoes, 78% on the audience.
So the audience is going down. I thought it was in the 80s last week, so the audience is starting to get a little wise to the fact that maybe this is not that good of a movie.
More people have watched it now.
Yeah, I want to, but there's other stuff. There's other stuff on, you know. I got to watch the Game of Thrones thing, the House of Dragon. I haven't seen that second episode yet.
We just watched some. We haven't finished it, so grain of salt. But we just started watching a movie on Netflix.
Oh, really?
It's called Me Time.
Mm.
It's got Kevin Hart and Mark Wahlberg in it.
I don't know this movie.
And if you're a fan of Mark Wahlberg shirtless, this is your movie.
Nice.
In fact, you see his bare ass, too.
What? You don't see his bare... No, is it him or a stunt guy?
Well, I haven't checked. I haven't got to the credits yet, but it looks like...
the part of Mark's ass.
Yeah, I think you just pulled that part up, but it's not blurred. Like, in the trailer, they show it blurred, but in the movie, his bare bottom's showing.
You know what? He's pretty ripped, but that's got to be his butt.
Yeah, I'm sure he has no problem showing off his body. The guy's got muscles on muscles.
That's the thing, yeah. You don't see Kevin Hart doing that. Well, Kevin Hart probably isn't pretty... He could do it, too, I suppose, if he wanted to.
It's a dumb comedy, but I enjoyed it so far.
Wait, Kevin Hart's in a dumb comedy?
Yes.
No.
Yeah, Jay Rubs and I watched that over the weekend as well.
Did you see the whole thing?
We did. We finished it last night, actually.
Did you like it?
It was a very stupid comedy. You're right.
Yes.
It's fun. It's, you know, it's Kevin Hart. You know, Kevin Hart really gets into his characters, which I appreciate, but the whole thing is like, what the hell's going on?
Is he Will Ferrell, though? I feel like Kevin Hart's now always Kevin Hart.
Maybe.
Yeah.
But it's funny like Sarah Kevin brought Hart. That up, BJ, because there was a moment during the movie where I was watching, like, he's really trying his best. Like, like he's giving his acting performance. Like, you can tell, like, the dude is not mailing it in.
All right.
And this is a movie that felt like all the other actors mailed it in.
Yes. But he's really giving the A for effort.
And what about Mark Wahlberg? Was he mailing it in or was he giving
Mark, on the other hand, was treating this like a movie that was just going straight to Netflix.
He was like, I got to get my insurance.
Right? Okay. Exactly, yeah.
I want to build a couple more Wahlburgers.
Thought this was going to the theaters or something.
Well, I'm not surprised it didn't go to the theaters based on the Rotten Tomato score.
Oh, no.
What did Me Time get?
Oh, man.
Okay.
Maybe I should watch the Sylvester Stallone. Just stop watching this movie.
Okay.
8%.
That is... If you're Kevin Hart, how are you in an 8% movie?
Money.
Oh, and the
percentage
audience
doesn't affect his cash. I'm sure there's no bonus based on Rotten Tomatoes.
Whoa, the audience, 31%. They like. I want to talk to those 31%. Like, how high were you?
Well, ask your daughter and J-Rob's, apparently.
Yeah.
Yeah. I would have probably given a little bit more than 31%, but probably not much.
I'm enjoying it, but I am not surprised whatsoever by that score.
Yeah.
Have you? All right, listen. Have any of you watched The Chef yet on Hulu?
No.
Because that's a good show. I mean, I get, and it's getting better and better with each episode, and I know it's done. I think it's done, but, you know, I'm still, you know, we're behind.
Wasn't it like The Bear?
Oh, thank you, The Bear. Thank you, Victor.
Because there's the Chef show on Netflix that has
they call everybody
John
Chef
Favreau
on the show. Like, everybody's name is Chef on the show because that's what you refer to.
I was thinking the Bear. Oh, okay,
It's The Bear. Thank you.
Oh, yeah. We watched an episode of that.
Dude, it gets better and better. And there was an episode where they basically had to cater a kid's birthday party. And it was, like, very, very funny.
Hey, our texters are coming.
That's a show you should be watching, not these horrible movies.
Well, yeah, texter said, "Me time, blanking hilarious." Like I said, okay, it's a dumb, fun movie.
That texter's high.
No,
maybe they are. 69% nice. Hate that movie.
No, 69% do not like that movie. Hate is a strong word, man.
Oh no, they're hate. I'm gonna bet that you know what they're like. This is trash.
There's plenty of things I don't like, but I don't hate them.
Oh yeah. All right. Well. I'm just gonna watch shows like The Bear. Sorry.
So instead, The Samaritan is actually a fun movie.
Okay.
All right. We'll leave it at that.
I mean, seriously, you know what? People who don't like it don't even have time to even. They don't even want to waste their minutes to tell us how much they didn't like that movie.
And a lot of people have been texting about Uncharted. I don't know that movie with Tom Holland. Apparently.
Oh, that was out in the theaters. Is it now free somewhere?
It must be because someone said, I just watched Uncharted this weekend with Tom Holland. What'd you guys think? Another person said, the wife and I just started watching the Uncharted movie. My wife loves your series idea when the kid takes a nap. So watching it in chunks.
Oh,
so
yeah.
It is on Netflix as of now. And Uncharted is based on a video game. So that's why a lot of people were digging
Mark Wahlberg in this too?
Oh, yeah.
No.
There he is.
What? Oh, there.
Does he show his bare ass? Because if not, I'm not watching.
Yeah, I need
to know this too.
Does Tom Holland show his bare ass? This is very
important. I'm down for anybody showing their bare ass. Antonio Banderas is also in this.
I didn't realize that was the case, so we'll have to see if we can find somebody.
And how's this doing on the tomatoes?
41 on the tomato meter, but audience score with over 5,000 verified ratings, 90%.
Wow, that's interesting.
Maybe we'll have to make the switch from Me Time to Uncharted.
Whoa.
Oh, and answer your question, the texture just said that, yes, I was very high, BJ, when watching the movie. Very high.
Listen, that changes everything.
Maybe I should have got high before I watched that movie.
Yeah.
Another person said, though, I was pretty high watching Me Time, and it still only had a few chuckles.
Yeah, there's just other stuff, man.
Come on.
There's other good stuff.
The wildcat scene was awesome.
Dude, seriously.
I was amped after that.
Go
scene.
On YouTube and watch all the highlights of Aubrey Plaza on Parks and Rec. Seriously, something like that. But, you know, or her and Ron Swanson together. I mean, that'll give you a better laugh.
Steve, what does a wildcat sound like in that movie?
it was kind of like stalking him. So like,
oh.
And then
this was Me Time?
Yeah.
I feel like I'm watching it again. Wow.
Yeah, there's a wild animal in it.
Let me hear that again. I kind of interrupted you, and I don't want to interrupt your greatness. What we got?
He asked me to do it twice?
Yeah.
Great artists can't do the same thing twice.
Oh, really? Well, then how about you then?
Okay.
What the hell's that? A laughing?
Well, like he said, he was stalking Kevin Hart at one point.
He's like, Kevin, what is it, a perverted
No!
Lion?
I don't...
Now it sounds like he's got asthma. How's this? Is the mountain lion okay? And now I'm sort of invested in the movie. I hope the mountain lion makes it.
I'm out.
I'm rooting for the lion.
I'm going with Rotten Tomatoes.
Oh,
I'm
there's the mountain lion. Okay.
Yeah, see right there. Yeah, he's like,
oh, when he's got. Oh. Okay, that looks like a funny scene, actually.
It's the best. I haven't watched much since past that, a little bit after that. It's such a great scene.
Oh, and the mountain lion hits him like a car. Okay. Oh, and there's Mark Wahlberg with like a Ranger hat on. Looks like Smokey the Bear.
Yes.
This does look like a dumb movie.
It's so dumb.
Yeah,
but
it really does.
I've been enjoying it.
Yeah, well, congratulations. I'm proud of you. All right, we have a big question that has to be answered. No, we got a great story here about this dude. Ooh, how about this dude had to get rescued by firefighters because his hand got stuck in a sofa? Okay. I'll tell you all about this at 9:52 on The Rock.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW.
99.9 KISW, The Rock of Seattle. Very bizarre situation these firefighters in Britain had to deal with. Last Tuesday, they got a call, and a man's like, hey, here's the thing. I got my hand trapped down the back of my sofa. Could you come help me out here?
Oh.
Wow. So he put his hand down the back of his sofa, and he couldn't get it back out again. And so the firefighters were the ones that had to come to the place and help him get his arm out of there. I mean, luckily, there was no injury. But they said he had a slight reddening of his hand.
Was the sofa, like, mounted to the wall? Like, I don't understand how... Can you just move the sofa?
They don't know how he... Here's what they're saying. We don't know how he got his arm jammed. We also don't know how he was able to call us to let us know that his arm was jammed.
Probably yelling Alexa, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah, if he's got one of those, you're right. Good call.
I don't know, Alexa, I'm an idiot. Call people to help me.
You know what? That's probably exactly what he said. How about this? One of the firefighters said... They don't just do fires, too, man. They're helping anybody, including with your hand stuck anywhere.
It could be worse. It could have been stuck somewhere else.
Yeah. Yeah. Ryan Kessel, he's next, and he doesn't have his hand stuck anywhere, but he does have a 12-pack.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW.
Today's podcast was brought to you by Travis Gagne, bankruptcy attorney. He's here right now and has agreed to answer more of your questions about bankruptcy. Here's another question from a listener. I have a mountain of credit card bills and consumer debt. Can I still keep my house if I file bankruptcy?
Yes, you almost always can keep your home and your house, your car in a bankruptcy. Depending on what type of bankruptcy you file, would depend on whether or not, for example, you can keep your vehicles if you have payments on them still. You can almost always keep your home if you're current on the payments on your home, even in full bankruptcy. In Chapter 13, you can also keep those items. If you're behind on your house, you could catch your house payments up in a Chapter 13, take off a second mortgage in a Chapter 13. So keeping your primary assets like a home and car is almost always possible in bankruptcy.
Thanks, Travis. If you have more questions about bankruptcy, you can reach out to Travis anytime at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com. And thanks for listening.
At Gaia Herbs, we work ridiculously hard, so our herbs work ridiculously hard for you. That's why, instead of making gummies with refined sugar, we developed our own organic fruit-based formula. And why we handpick our leaves off our ginkgo trees to avoid whatever's on the ground. And why we test and retest everything in the lab for maximum potency. Because the harder we work, the harder our herbs work for you. Explore our herbs at GaiaHerbs.com/hardestworking. That's GAIA Herbs.com/hardestworking. Gaia Herbs, the hardest working herbs on earth.